Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 4 and 5 in private. Has everybody agreed?
Yes.
Yep, thank you very much. And we now turn to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on budget savings and reductions for 2022-23. On the 7th of September, John Swinney announced £500 million in-year reductions to the budget. Some of these are relevant to our remit, namely employability, education maintenance allowance, concessionary fares and rail fares, and child poverty consequentials. And I welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, and who's also at the moment covering the finance brief. And his officials, Julie Humphreys, who's the Deputy Director tackling child poverty and financial wellbeing, and Michael Walker, who is the Senior Finance Business Partner at the Scottish Government. And I'll hand over to the Deputy First Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss the emergency budget review and the underlying savings that are of interest to the committee. I set out to Parliament, as you have said, Convener, on the 7th of September, the hard prioritisation choices the Government has had to take, with the pressures of inflation placing a significant new burden within our budgets, a burden that was not planned for when the spending review was undertaken by the United Kingdom Government last autumn. People and businesses have also been deeply impacted by the cost of living crisis, and this Government has vowed to do everything we can to mitigate this crisis as far as possible. We must do that whilst meeting the increased costs of public sector pay and balancing our public finances. My letter to the Finance Committee highlighted over £500 million in savings and reforecasting which we have had to take forward. The options are challenging, but we must do this in order to move to balance our budget and to do everything we can to help those in need. This is, of course, the harsh reality of a fixed budget and limited fiscal powers. In addition, the majority of our spend cannot be changed at this stage of the financial year due to contractual and legal commitments. Therefore, there are limited options to make savings. I should also note that the 2022-23 element of our emergency budget review is part of normal financial management practices, with a number of savings arising as a result of natural demand. Formal scrutiny of budget changes will be undertaken through our normal budget revisions process, and impact assessments will, of course, be taken forward as part of the annual budgetary process. Notwithstanding the financial challenges we are facing, the Government remains firmly focused on tackling and reducing child poverty and supporting strong and sustainable growth as part of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. Our 22-23 budget continues to take forward key programmes and policies, such as the increase to the Scottish Child Payment to £25 per eligible child per week from the 14th of November, the Fuel and Security Fund, and widening access to the Warmer Homes Fuel Poverty Programme. Finally, Convener, I would note that I intend to publish the outcome of the emergency budget review in the week beginning the 24th of October. Further savings are likely to be required to balance the budget. I look forward to this morning's discussion and very happy to answer questions from the committee.
Many thanks for that, Deputy First Minister. I'll turn to members for questions. And we do have questions grouped into a few themes. We've got employability, education, maintenance allowance, concessionary fares and transport costs, and cost of living consequentials and child poverty. But members also, as ever, have their own questions, which we will bring them in on towards the end as well. So to start us off, if members can direct their questions to the Deputy First Minister, who will bring in his officials when he decides to. Well, to start us off, we've got Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for coming this morning, and also thank you for the information that you shared in advance. I know in the letter that we received recently that you said you've taken decisions that you consider to have least impact. And in relation to the employability service cuts, how have you carried out that assessment of impact? What organisations have you spoke to?
In relation to the choices that we face, I think it's important that I re-emphasise a point that I made in my opening statement. That at this stage in the financial year, the range of options that are available to me are really rather limited because, obviously, of the degree of contractual and legal commitments that are made in any circumstance during the financial year. But when you get to the midpoint of the financial year, significant programmes have already been allocated and undertaken. Now, in relation, so the room for manoeuvre, the choices are quite limited once we get to this stage in the financial year. Second point I would make is that in relation to the employability budget, the employability budget will actually increase in this financial year compared to what was planned. It will, if my memory serves me right, it will be of the order of a move from about £56 million to about £71 million. It's just the scale of the increase is not going to be as great as we originally planned. So the budget was planned to go from about £56 million to about £120 million. I've regrettably had to remove £53 million to that budget, given the fact that that is was uncommitted expenditure. It was it wasn't legally committed to any organisations. So I felt that was, given the growth in the budget, given the fact that we are experiencing at this stage persistently low unemployment, that it was a budget saving that on the balance of risk was one that I could afford to take. Obviously, in these decisions, I ultimately have to take the decisions, and although it's one that I would have wanted to avoid, it brings forward, it's a necessity that we've got to confront.
Thank you for that answer. And I appreciate that the opportunities available to you, particularly in year, are limited. So who did you speak with when considering what opportunities or what options you had? Which organisations did you engage? And I appreciate it would have been in a short order, but did you speak to any organisations or people to discuss the potential impacts of cuts to these services, including, for example, on disabled people, lone parents and women?
We carry out a great deal of discussion with organisations about the formulation of our budget priorities, so we've got a good awareness of the issues. So when we're taking decisions about setting out the plans for expanding the range of employability services as part of the formulation of our wider programmes, we would engage with a range of organisations. So the government has that knowledge of what is involved in these programmes. We also have strong monitoring information on the capacity of the existing programmes that will be untouched by these changes. So there is still adequate capacity within the existing programmes to be able to deal with referrals of individuals. So in our existing programmes that are untouched by these changes, there remains existing capacity within those programmes to support individuals who require employability assistance. So on the basis of those assessments, I came to the conclusion this was a saving that the government could take and which would be able to be, we'd be able to manage the implications of that because we still had capacity within our existing programmes.
Thank you for that answer. I have one further question in this area. Thank you. The process that you set out, that you said there is already a process there for you to engage with these organisations, but we heard in committee last week from the Scottish Human Rights Commission that process was, and I think I'm quoting, not a brilliant process. And so that's where my concerns lie, because in any on a good day, we rely on processes to be really, really good. And in a difficult day, and I'm sure the decisions that you were taking were difficult, if this process is not quite up to scratch, then that makes it all the worse. So given that, and given some of the concerns that we also heard around the third sector and their concerns about the ability of the No One Left Behind approach, for example, to have dealt with capacity in the first place, what could you do between now and when you bring the emergency budget to reassure those organisations that that you'll take account of their issues and needs and the people they represent?
When I look at the way in which government engages, you know, there's extensive engagement with organisations in the formulation of our plans. And you know, at a personal level, I'm involved in some of these discussions. But my colleagues, the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, principally, takes forward a whole range of different discussions with organisations who will have an interest in the sphere of employability, as will the Minister for Employment. I think the government generally has every opportunity to hear and to understand the perspectives of different organisations in that respect. Obviously, we will continue that dialogue. I will be talking to a range of different interested parties as I finalise issues around the emergency budget review. We've had a number of submissions from organisations about what should resources be available to assist with cost of living challenges, where they should best be deployed, and the committee will be familiar with the range of propositions that have come forward from organisations. And we will certainly undertake that further dialogue. Obviously, in relation to the questions of equality impact assessments, these are carried out in relation to budget statements and budget programmes, and we'll continue to do exactly that.
Thanks.
Thank you very much for that, and we'll now hand over to Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning, and again, thank you very much for making me time this morning. I suppose just following on from the questions from Pam Clancy Duncan, in regard to the employability reduction, what will be the practical effect? So you said that, you know, this is an increase in budget, it won't affect services that have been provided. I'm just trying to work out, what is this extra £56 million was planned to do if it's not going to affect direct services?
My point to Pam Duncan Glancy was that existing services are maintained. So the existing provision has been maintained. So, for example, the work that's undertaken in the employability and workforce skills programmes, No One Left Behind, the employability Fair Start Scotland work, that all remains in place. It's just a planned increase in expenditure is not taking place as a consequence of the pressures that we face. So the employability budget lines were projected to increase from £56 million to £125 million, and they instead will increase from £56 to £71. So it's simply that an expansion of capacity has not been undertaken. Now, the consequences of that are that should we have been able to... You know, what was planned here was for us to try to make greater inroads in supporting people who are currently economically inactive to become economically active. Now, I take the view, it's not a universally held view, that people who are economically inactive require significant holistic support to assist them into employment. It is unlikely that that's going to be a straightforward journey. You know, the labour market, there's plenty of opportunity within the labour market just now, but if people are economically inactive, there is likely to be a wider contextual challenge. So what we had been planning to do was to expand some of that support, which by its nature is likely to be, if I put it into per capita terms, a more expensive degree of intervention, to try to make greater inroads into the economically inactive population. And the budget restrictions that I've had to put in place are likely to mean that we won't be able to do as much of that as we wanted to do.
That's helpful, and I agree with your analysis of the situation as well, Deputy First Minister. I suppose the issue is that, particularly around disability, coming out of COVID, the number of disabled people who are unemployed has gone up compared to what it was pre-COVID. And that's true across many other parts of the world, so it's not just a Scottish issue. But the number of disabled people who are unemployed in Scotland is much higher now, percentage-wise, than in, for example, England. And I suppose the concern I have around this is that those who are particularly disabled, who are wanting to get back into employability, are not going to get these services? And is it your analysis that the figure is likely to grow wider, that more disabled people will be unemployed in the next 6 or 9 months because they're not getting that holistic support that they need to get into employability?
I don't think that will be the case, because of the answer I gave to Pam Duncan-Glancy, that there remains capacity within our programmes to support individuals and to deal with referrals. So Mr Balfour is correct that good progress has been made on narrowing the employability gap amongst disabled people. So that progress has been made. It's been made in the aftermath of COVID. In addition to that, our existing programmes, which remain unaffected by these changes, still have capacity to support individuals. I suppose what I would have to concede is that the rate of progress might not be as fast as I would like to see in reducing the employability gap as a consequence. But as I have set out to the committee, I am faced with some very difficult choices to try to balance the budget in this financial year, and choices of this type are the ones that remain open to me.
Just my final question of this section is, obviously you're coming back to the whole of the Parliament in 2 or 3 weeks' time with your budget. Obviously there was the UK budget last week, which I think would have given some Barnett consequentials in regard to that. Has that in any way been able to, and I appreciate it's early days, it's less than a week, but is there any mitigation now around those Barnett consequences, which means this cut or reduction, whichever word you want to use, might not have to now take place?
The implications of the United Kingdom government's mini-budget last Friday in Barnett consequentials for this financial year, and I stress that the conversation we are having at the committee this morning is just about this financial year, total £35 million. And that's as a consequence of the changes that are being made in stamp duty. That gives rise to that consequential. So I've taken no decisions about that. Obviously, I am, well, to say the least, uncertain about whether or not the changes that were made last Friday will actually come to pass, given the fact that there is enormous market volatility being experienced. But that's the available impact on this financial year, and I'll obviously be considering these questions as I formulate the provisions around the emergency budget review. I would stress to Mr Balfour, just for completeness and accuracy, that the emergency budget review will be looking at the issues around this financial year and the balancing of this year, and obviously budget statements will be made later in the year in the normal sequence of events and accompanied by the normal level of forecasting that Parliament would expect.
Thank you very much for that. Pam, did you have a supplementary to this before you take us into the next section?
I do, and I can run it on if that's helpful.
Yep, that would be helpful, and then that will be followed by Miles Briggs after.
Thank you very much, Convener. Following on briefly, before I move to the next bit, from my colleague Jeremy Balfour's question, I hear that you say that the current level of service will continue and that there won't be as big a scale of increase. But that worries me, because the current level of service is still delivering quite high numbers of disabled people unemployed in Scotland, and it concerns me that cutting that again, and so putting the money in the first place would have been helpful, taking it out now is, I think, going to have serious consequences. So, and actually the SHRC said last week that it was that doing so was removing a poverty prevention method. So I do worry about it, about this, the impact of this on disabled people's poverty. Have you looked at that? Will you look at that with the emergency budget review, and do you have any indication as to the impact you think this might have on the Scottish Government's targets to close the disability employment gap?
Obviously, I look at all of this information because, as a member of the the Cabinet, I carry collective responsibility for the Government's objectives. So the success of the Government's programmes in whatever area of policy they happen to be matters to me. So I want to ensure we can be successful. I was heavily involved in the formulation of the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, for example. So these issues are, you know, very material to me in the conduct of policy. But I come up against hard financial choices, and I understand the concerns that people will have about the scale of increase not being as great as we would like. I think this is in a difficult context, a rational policy choice, because we have existing capacity, we have available capacity within existing programmes to support our endeavour, but we may not be able to put as much resource into this as we would like, given the financial pressures that we face. So that's the dilemma I'm trying to square. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I have a legal duty to balance the budget, and where there is an increase in financial pressure, which comes from a number of different elements, it comes from the erosion of the value of our budget because of inflation being essentially more than double what was predicted to be, it undermines the value of our budget to the tune of £1.7 billion. Secondly, there is the necessity to resolve public sector pay claims, and they are coming in much higher than were anticipated in the budget. So I have to find resources to balance all of that. In that context, we have to take considered policy choices. They might be difficult. They might have wider ramifications, but I'm trying to do that in a way that protects programmes that still enable us to pursue the policy agenda to which we have committed ourselves. But I will keep the issues very much under review.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate the context in which the decisions have been taken. I have to say I'm not convinced that I'm reassured that those decisions have fully taken into consideration a number of the priority groups, for example, in the Child Poverty Plan, and also people with protected characteristics. And I don't think I've heard that reassurance today, I'm afraid. I'll move on to the next question, which is around Education Maintenance Alliance. And my question on that is really that I wonder, it looks like you're budgeting for failure of uptake. And so the first question is, should we not be trying to encourage people to take up the money and benefits in which they're entitled? And my second question is, if people do take it up and there is a higher than forecast uptake, I know it's a demand-led budget, what are your plans to get money from elsewhere?
On the first point, in the whole question, educational maintenance allowance is an entitlement. So should an individual apply for it, they must get it, regardless of the size of the budget. So we do our level best to estimate the likely demand for education maintenance allowances. Historically, it has the budget line has underspent. And one of our obligations in terms of our approach to the management of the public finances is to make sure that we follow the guidance that budgets should be taught and realistic. So in circumstances where I have got to try to allocate resources, because I'm quite literally in a situation just now where I'm having to take resources from one area of the government's budget to allocate to another to pay public sector pay claims, for example, I'm having to find money to do that across different areas of government. I have to make sure that there is budget clarity for accountable officers, that they have the necessary finance to spend. So if I have, for example, £3 million in an education maintenance allowance budget line that I don't think I will require, I can take that away and put it somewhere else to address a public sector pay claim, and that allows me to fulfil the obligations or support the obligations of accountable officers within the government. Obviously, that's us making a judgment based on the best evidence we have available to us. Should the total costs for education maintenance allowances be greater, then that will be a financial pressure I will have to address during the course of the financial year. But all of these budgets are monitored on a daily basis, frankly, and the information is being provided to me to enable me to make judgments about where it is appropriate for us to reallocate expenditure to meet financial pressures. But I stress the point, the education maintenance allowance is an entitlement. So if demand outstrips the £22 million provision that will be retained in the budget, then I will have to find the resources to accommodate that. But I think, based on previous years' experience, this is an appropriate judgment to make.
Okay. Thank you.
Very much for that. Over to yourself, Miles.
Good morning, Mrs. Swinney. Good morning to your officials as well. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to carry on that further line of questioning Pam Duncan-Glancy started with. Do you think cutting EMA budget is consistent with also in trying to improve uptake amongst those moving on from the Scottish Child Payment as well?
Yes, because it's a demand-led budget, so whoever is entitled to it will get it. It's simply about making sure that with the degree of pressure that I am having to deal with within this financial year, I don't have money allocated into particular budget lines where that money is unlikely to be required, but it is required in other budget lines.
Okay, thank you. An important part of this, and I think you've outlined this already to committee, is around projected underspends or projected lack of uptake of benefits, which are currently available. So I just wondered, in terms of this year's in-year spend, where other benefits, for example, Best Start Grant, for example, is sitting at, and whether or not these sorts of areas are also being earmarked as potential areas where there will be finance currently allocated, but it will not be particularly spent in this year.
There's no evidence that I have so far that I'm in a I've made two decisions essentially on demand-led budgets, on education maintenance allowances and on concessionary travel. I don't have any evidence that allows me at this stage to make any other judgments about any other programmes, but as I said in my last answer to Pam Duncan-Glancy, these issues have been monitored on my behalf on a daily basis, and obviously I will make further judgments on these points. These are, of course, in the normal sequence of events, fairly regular changes that are made by government as we assess demand for particular programmes at either the autumn or the spring budget revisions, and those formal opportunities will be available to Parliament to consider the implications of any changes in demand.
Okay. Thank you for that. It would be helpful, I think, if you could provide that information to the committee as well. Some of our work we're trying to do to encourage uptake, for example, to see where that sits. And just finally, in this section, I wondered, a lot of people are seeking clarity now over how this will trickle down to other services. And I wondered where protections are being expected by ministers, for example, schemes around supporting young carers, and what work was being undertaken around that?
I've set out in my letter to the Finance Committee particular specific changes that are being made. If there are further changes to be made, I will do that transparently. I've been completely open with Parliament about this. There's no obligation of me to come to Parliament in September with the statement that I made. I could have left this all to the autumn budget revision, but I feel in the interest, I've got a duty of candour to Parliament that Parliament should hear the issues and difficulties with which I am wrestling, and that those should be set out to members of Parliament. So if there are any further changes of that nature, then they'll be set out in a similar fashion.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to a theme which we've already touched on regarding concessionary fares and transport costs. And to start us off, we've got Jeremy Balfour. Thanks.
Thank you. And just a couple of questions on Mr. Vatchell, Deputy. First Minister. The first one is in regard to how did you make the decision to cut this particular budget, and what effect will it have in regard to encouraging people to use public transport rather than necessarily their cars?
The judgment that I was making here is essentially looking at the available data to us about the levels of usage of public transport in the current context. We fixed our budget. Obviously, concessionary travel is a crucial social and economic benefit within our society. We make our best estimates of what we reckon will be the uptake of the concessionary travel scheme. The data that's available to us as we look through the financial year, as we look at the degree to which people are returning to public transport in the aftermath of COVID, where obviously there's a degree of nervousness or anxiety in relation to utilising public transport, and made a judgment about where we think demand will eventually settle for this again. There's a degree of judgment involved here, and ultimately, if we find the budget line exceeds what I have predicted in this latest update, then we will have to meet that cost from other areas within the budget. But I am hopeful that the steps we have taken will be appropriate and will have the necessary accuracy about the predictions in the budget.
If I could just pick up one particular scheme, Matt, for the new youth concessionary travel scheme. I say this as somebody who is a non-driver, so I use the bus a lot. It does amaze me how many children are still not using it in Edinburgh, because obviously put my fare in, you know, paying for it. And I think one of the reasons is because it's actually quite complicated to fill in, and I say that as somebody who tried three times to get it for my own children. And there is variation across Scotland of how you apply, how easy it is to apply. And I wonder, again, not necessarily for this budget, but looking forward, are there ways that the Scottish Government can look at to make applying for this easier? Because it does concern me, particularly those who struggle with internet or don't have a passport, are not necessarily picking up this. And they may be the people who actually need it more than perhaps others who have already applied for it.
I am aware that there are different approaches taken in different parts of the country about what support is available to people. For example, my own son, the arrangement for his national entitlement card was handled through the school, and it was done very efficiently. It was a totally and completely straightforward process, absolutely no difficulty whatsoever. And he is now using his national entitlement card with some gusto. We've got actually for a scheme that's only been open since January, really quite high levels of uptake in a relatively short space and time. We are obviously promoting awareness about the national entitlement card amongst young people, and we'd encourage them to take that up. But we're making necessary judgments about the volume of usage, which allows me to make the judgments I've made about the size of the budget.
Thank you
very much. Pam, over to yourself.
Thank you, Convener. Just following on from that, the decision that you've come to in terms of the use of buses, did you look at the use during the COVID pandemic, or did you look at comparable years before that? Because it strikes me that, and I'm sure you'll appreciate with your other hat in terms of COVID recovery, disabled people and older people have been a bit more reticent to go back to using buses. And so I'd be worried if the amount was based only on very recent patronage.
It's a combination of both that we've looked at. Essentially, the earlier budget estimates were based, I think it'd be fair to say, probably assumed a greater, well, they did assume a greater recovery in public transport patronage post-pandemic than has actually materialised. Now, I stress, again, this is an entitlement So if it translates into more cost, then I'll have to address that issue in the course of further judgments that are made in the course of this financial year, which would simply add to the pressures that I'm wrestling with at a different stage in the financial year. But we're looking at the comparison between pre-COVID levels, COVID levels, and if I use the terminology COVID recovery levels, to form the best estimate. I'm not going to sit in front of the committee this morning and say that I'm absolutely 100% confident we've got that absolutely precise. We will continue to monitor that as the year progresses, and if there is a need to put in further financial support, then of course we'll do that.
Thank you. Can I follow on, convener, to my questions that I had in addition to this particular area? Is that okay?
I bring you back in on that, because I've got members that have got additional questions?
Yes.
Is that okay? Thank you very much. I'll hand back over to Jeremy Balfour, who's going to start us off on cost of living consequentials and child poverty.
Yeah, thank you. Again, it's just wonder if we get a wee bit more detail in regard to the £82 million. How was it going to be used in the first place? I'm not sure I could find my information within anything that the Scottish Government have let to it. So by £82 million, what was it going to be used for?
Well, the £82 million is a product of decisions taken by the United Kingdom Government that give rise to a consequential. As members will know, these consequentials come into our budget, and they don't come in with a badge on them. They come in as consequentials, and we decide the allocation that is made. We obviously have a range of different measures that are provided in Scotland that are not provided in other parts of the United Kingdom that assist with the cost of living challenges, and we've allocated resources. The £82 million has essentially been allocated into the Scottish Government's budget to assist us in meeting the various elements of expenditure that we are putting in to support the programmes that we have to assist on the cost of living and other matters within our budget.
If I can push a wee bit, I'm not sure I still actually understand what this £82 million. I appreciate it goes into a big pot, and you decide how that pot is spent. But it's hard for this committee, it's hard for the Parliament to know the intended purpose if we don't know how that £82 million was going to be spent. So, I mean, was it in regard to Social Security? Was it education? You know, presumably you had allocated £82 million to a particular government department, particular budget. I'm just wondering where that is coming from.
Essentially, it doesn't come in with an intended purpose. It comes in as a consequential, and the government then decides how it's going to be spent. And essentially, for completeness, I've set out that in meeting the financial pressures that we are facing, we are allocating this within the wider budget management of the Scottish Government, which of course is dealing with a range of different requirements, whether that's on tackling child poverty, dealing with the cost of living, supporting individuals with their energy costs through elements such as the Fuel Security Fund and various other measures of that type.
Maybe just one more time. I mean, on practical levels, will it mean a particular service has been affected? You know, it's a reasonable amount of money, so does that mean a third sector charity won't be getting it? There won't be a particular project that will be now run. I appreciate it's high level, but what consequence will this have for individuals in Scotland for the next 6 months?
It means that a range of programmes are being funded that ordinarily wouldn't have been able to be funded had we not allocated the money in the way that I'm allocating priorities today within the Scottish Government's budget.
And can you give us a list of those programmes?
It doesn't really operate in that fashion, because as Mr Balfour said earlier on in his questions, the money comes into the wider pot of public finance, and from that I have to support a range of programmes. So, you know, we wouldn't be able to afford the budget provisions that we have if I wasn't allocating the £82 million towards the range of programmes that are supported across the Scottish Government. But it's not, it doesn't come in badged and in that particular fashion that enables me to say, well, £10 million of that £82 million has gone towards this or that. It's part of the general financing of the Scottish Government's budget. And then all these issues are reconciled in the annual budget, the autumn budget revision and the spring budget revision.
Okay, I think I'm a bit confused, but I'm sure others will pick this up. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move on to questions that members have themselves. And to start us off, we've got Paul McLennan, then to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Paul?
Yeah, thank you, Deputy First Minister. You obviously mentioned at the start of around about the fiscal limitations, and I know I've asked you this before, but obviously just for the sake of the committee, around about the discussions you're having with the UK Government around about the fiscal framework. In terms of that, one, obviously you mentioned about the budget being inflation-proofed, and just to see what discussions you've had on that, as you mentioned, it's £1.7 billion less, and of course, the Social Security Committee is very much demand-led. A lot of the services we look at are very much demand-led. So it's around about the ability for additional borrowing power, and what a difference that would make, particularly in regards to, obviously, this budget, probably more than others.
But we, in relation to the current financial situation and the issues with which I'm wrestling, I have written to I and the Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, have written to UK ministers, various chancellors. We've had quite a few in the course of the last few weeks, and might have more, to make the case that the effect of inflation has been to erode the value of our budget, to make an appeal, as I have done with my counterparts in Wales and Northern Ireland, for there to be an uplift to budgets to deal with public sector pay pressures and the pressures of inflation. Why is that necessary? It's necessary because I have, unless there is a positive change in English public expenditure during a financial year, our budget doesn't change. So we have essentially a fixed budget. Once the tax year starts, I am required by law to set a tax rate. It can't be changed during a financial year, so tax can't change. We have resource borrowing powers that only extend, I think I would characterise them as cash management resource borrowing powers. They don't allow you to accumulate a resource borrowing capacity. So essentially we are dependent on any changes to budgets that are made in England. Now, we've been writing a series of letters to chancellors, to prime ministers. We've been getting no response. I spoke to the Chief Secretary to the Treasury on Friday in the aftermath of the mini budget, and the Chief Secretary made it clear to me on Friday that he was aiming to, he was insisting on the application of the current comprehensive spending review, so that means no uplift to budgets. And I notice in news information overnight, the Chief Secretary has now written to Whitehall departments, or is in the process of writing to Whitehall departments, requiring reductions in expenditure. So that is not an encouraging sign for what lies ahead in relation to future years' expenditure.
Just a supplementary, if that's okay. Just on the subject of additional borrowing, can you outline what difference that would make to yourself in terms of looking at this particular budget? As I said, we've talked around about how that's led by demand. A lot of these services are led by demand. What a difference that would make to yourself. I'm aware, obviously, there are other devolved governments out with the UK that have these powers.
Yeah.
What a difference that would make to yourself in terms of how we look at some of the issues we've been talking about today?
Well, as I've said to Parliament already, if you look at the pay deals that we are having to put in place because of the effect of inflation, clearly, members of staff, public servants are concerned about their financial situation, so they want some protection from inflation. And I was involved extensively in the dialogue around the local government pay settlement, which I'm glad we got to a conclusion. We estimate that we will have to find in the public purse £700 million more for pay than we anticipated. That's why I'm having to make many of these changes, to make sure that we can actually afford. And then if you take the local government pay deal, the local government pay deal significantly enhances the position for staff on low incomes. Very significant increases, in excess of 10% in the pay for low-income members of staff, which I very much welcome. It still doesn't amount to an awful lot of money for those individuals, and nothing like what some very affluent people are going to get from the tax cuts that were announced last Friday, but it's welcome progress nonetheless. But those decisions put financial strain on our budget, and these concerns are echoed by my counterparts in Wales and Northern Ireland, who operate within exactly the same constraints.
Just to clarify, I mean, obviously you mentioned about the inflation aspect was £1.7 billion on the budget. You're almost saying that the public sector pay increase, obviously, you mentioned was another £700 million. So you're affected because of inflation, the impact of inflation. So you're literally talking the £1.7 billion plus the £700 million?
No, they're two slightly different numbers. I think it's important to, the £1.7 billion is essentially the erosion of the value of our expenditure. The £700 million is hard money. That is money that has to be found. So,
£2.4 billion on.
I think I would pause about adding the two numbers together, okay. Mr. McLennan, if you'll forgive me. But I think, but the point I'm making is that, whatever we debate about the erosion of value, there's £700 million has to be found in hard money in the budget, which has to balance by the end of the year, which we weren't anticipating at the start of the financial year. And that is the challenge I'm trying to wrestle with.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Deputy First Minister. I think that kind of clarifies that for us all. If we move to questions from Natalie Dawn, to be followed by Emma Roddick. Natalie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister. You mentioned the joint letter from yourself and the other devolved governments to the Chancellor, and in that letter you talk about the need for the UK Government to provide more targeted action. So given that the UK Government holds the key fiscal levers in addition to key powers over energy and around 85% welfare, could you outline what action you think the UK Government needs to take now to help people?
I think that on the issue of energy costs, and this point, well, the two points I will address in relation to energy costs and in relation to welfare are points which I think were made very powerfully by the statement from the International Monetary Fund on Tuesday evening, because essentially the International Monetary Fund argued for targeted intervention, and it's that this is one of the elements of weakness in what the United Kingdom government is doing. The measures are not sufficiently or specifically targeted, and as a consequence of that, they are contributing to the financial volatility that we're experiencing. So, obviously, people on low incomes are significantly disadvantaged in being able to cope with significant increases in energy bills compared to people who are more financially secure. So in terms of the energy cost provisions, we would have liked to have seen that much more firmly targeted on people in fuel poverty. And we are now seeing, of course, extensive growth in levels of fuel poverty in Scotland as a consequence. And then in relation to the wider questions about household income, a very straightforward, a very effective and a measure to tackle this issue, and of course for which there is precedent, would be an expansion of universal credit. And that's an intensely targeted measure. The Scottish Child Payment, which is a product of our intervention, is an intensely targeted payment on those who face financial challenge. So those would be some of the areas in which we could see more focused intervention by the UK government, which would create much more targeted benefit for those who suffer the most.
Thank you. We've talked this morning about reductions in spending, but you mentioned it yourself a second ago. The Scottish Government has highlighted its increase to and extension of the Scottish Child Payment as a key measure that the Government has taken to help families and to tackle child poverty. Now, is it not the case that without full powers, the actions that this Scottish Government take continue to be undermined by the UK Government's inaction or policies that actively undermine Scottish Government efforts to tackle child poverty?
Well, we face a situation where, and I am increasingly worried about this, and I'm even more worried about it, having heard what I've heard being briefed from the Treasury last night about spending constraints. The consequence of the budget, the mini-budget last Friday, has been to loosen fiscal policy. And I disagree with a large number of the measures and the approach that's been taken. I think the way in which it's been taken has been disastrous, because fiscal policy has been loosened and there has been no explanation about how it will be delivered in a sustainable way. So I'm not in any way surprised that the markets have responded the way they have responded, because it is just the absolute height of fiscal responsibility, fiscal irresponsibility. So if the UK government wants to recover from its fiscal irresponsibility, it's got to tighten fiscally, and that will come on spending. And that's a disaster for us, because the block grant pays for the child payment. And if the UK government decides to tighten budgets affecting English departments, that will tighten the budget in Scotland. So the point that Natalie Dawn puts to me is absolutely 100% correct, that decisions taken by the UK government, fiscally irresponsible last Friday, will have to be rectified if they want to avoid a financial crash. And in so doing, they will tighten the budgets in Scotland. And what we are facing just now, which is a consequence of raging inflation, which is, again, a product of fiscal irresponsibility, is going to be a much graver problem that we have to face in years to come as a consequence of these decisions.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Back to Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Over to Emma Roddick, who will be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Emma.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister. Last week we heard from CPAG about a number of asks of yourself, including some mitigation measures. It was Professor Philip Alston, UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty and Human Rights, who said mitigation comes at a price and is not sustainable. Would you agree with that comment, and can you give an indication of how much Scottish Government spending is currently going towards mitigation?
I suppose I agree with one part of the statement, which is that mitigation comes at a price. It certainly does. And the Scottish Government is meeting the costs of mitigation of a number of United Kingdom Government measures. I'm not sure I quite accept the point that it's not sustainable, because I view it as my duty to make it sustainable, because I want to protect people from the hardship that is inflicted on them as much as I possibly can do. But the point I would accept is there are limits to fiscal sustainability, which is where I find myself quite close to at this particular moment. I've had to come to Parliament and I'm obviously here at committee to explain the rationale for that, to deal with a level of financial pressure which, if I don't address it now, I will be in danger of being unable to balance the budget this year. So I have a record of fiscal responsibility. I believe in fiscal responsibility, so that's why we're doing what we're doing. In relation to now, I obviously am working to ensure that we operate in a sustainable fashion, because measures such as the Scottish Child Payment that I just discussed with Natalie Dawn, I view that as absolutely fundamental to the commitments we can make to the most vulnerable in our society to support them through a really difficult period. And I think the Scottish Child Payment is a fantastic intervention, but it wouldn't be necessary if universal credit was at a credible level. That would be much. We wouldn't have to face that in our budget if universal credit wasn't was at a more credible level. So, the in terms of quantifying the effects of mitigation, I think I would have to. I think I'd probably be safer saying that I should write to the committee about what that an estimate of that calculation would be. But there are, of course, measures such as the child payment, which are being applied by the Scottish Government, totalling very close to £200 million. Actually, the updated forecast on the Scottish Child Payment is £219 million for this financial year. Some of that, of course, is because we've accelerated the payment or the bring forward of the increase to the 14th of November. So that's one element. Ms Roddick will be familiar with the fact that the government mitigates the bedroom tax, which is a critical measure in alleviating one of the more pernicious aspects of the UK welfare regime. And there are a range of other measures that we take forward, but I think for completeness I should probably write to the committee with a detailed answer on that point.
Thank you very much for that. I think it's clear from the fiscal announcement last week that the UK government is going down a, funnily enough, very conservative path, cutting tax for high earners and uncapping bankers' bonuses. Peter Kelly from the Poverty Alliance has told this committee that governing is about decisions. Is the Scottish government making different priorities and different decisions?
We are, but in so doing, we are trying to do so in a way that protects the fundamental values that we believe in and the fundamental elements of our programme for government. So Emma Roddick will be familiar with the programme for government that was set out just at the beginning of September. It is a programme that develops the thinking that emerged from the government's manifesto in the 2021 election, which was based on essentially ensuring that we secure a fairer and a greener future for individuals in our society. Those priorities and those values were reinforced by the Bute House Agreement with the Scottish Green Party, and that now flows into the programme for government. So we are setting that direction, which is about ensuring that we create a fairer society, that we make the transition to net zero, that we do so to create new and sustainable employment opportunities within Scotland. Those are the underpinning values, and the decisions that I'm taking are designed to protect that programme as much as I can do, but clearly, by the nature of the decisions that I've had to take, that creates significant financial strain on the Scottish Government.
It does sound difficult, and we're maybe getting to the point where it's impossible to be, for a centre-left government to be working within a fiscal framework set by a more right-wing government elsewhere, while also mitigating a lot of its decisions. Is this a demonstration of why we require independence?
I think that sums it up in a nutshell. There is, you know, we are. You know, I've got a long track record in this Parliament, and as a minister, I served for 9 years as Finance Minister. I find myself very surprisingly back in the finance area of activity. I have never seen financial strain and pressure like I am seeing just now, and I'm wrestling with. And I don't use those words lightly. I managed through the financial crash, I managed through the years of austerity under George Osborne and Danny Alexander. I left the finance brief in 2016 thinking that we had perhaps managed to mitigate the worst of austerity, and that was as nothing compared to what we're now wrestling with. And the fundamental point that Emma Roddick puts to me, which is as a centre-left government, believing in progressive values, wishing to secure a fairer and a greener future for our fellow human beings in this community finds that ever more difficult with an agenda being pursued, which is, well, I actually wouldn't accuse it of being conservative. I don't, because there's, you know, there's certain kind of protections of core values that are associated with conservatism, and I don't recognise that in the financial statement last Friday.
Just a small amount of time left, but if we can, I would like to bring Pam Duncan-Glancy back in with a quick question, and then Miles Briggs. Pam?
Thank you, Convener. And in the interest of brevity, I'll resist temptation to discuss the constitutional settlement that we've just touched on. We've spent some considerable time on that. One of the things that I've been trying to get from this morning, and I think it is really important, is that in the decisions that are taken, including in the decisions that you've said yourself should be fiscally responsible, and I take the view that cuts to employability for disabled people and others is not particularly fiscally responsible, because it will have an impact, of course, on the fiscal status. How can you reassure us this morning, and I haven't heard it so far, that you will involve organisations and groups like the Women's Budget Group in in-year decisions as well as longer-term budgeting processes? And will you make a commitment to do that today so that they can help you and provide the expertise so that you can make fiscally responsible decisions as well as decisions that don't further entrench inequality?
On the first observation that Pam Duncan-Glancy makes, I take a very different view about the constitutional arguments, because I think they're central to the dilemmas that I face, because I think the analysis that Emma Roddick put to me is absolutely correct. And I think the ability of a Scottish Parliament to exercise the full range of powers that, you know, for example, in Ireland yesterday, the Irish government set out a budget diametrically different.
First Minister, the question, I would love to debate those issues with you at length, but we don't have enough time, I think, to go into that. My questions were about the way in which you make the decisions in the budget that you currently control. And so I would really appreciate some reassurance on the record, because there are a number of organisations looking for it.
Yeah, well, I'll come on to that. But if we look at the comparative example in the Republic of Ireland, dramatically different decisions have been taken by an independent country in close proximity to us that's made different constitutional choices. And I think there's an important lesson for us in that comparison. I'm very happy to engage in all groups with all groups on as much as I can on these issues. I'll listen to people's perspectives. I think I've got a track record of listening to different views. I enjoyed, when I was Finance Minister, my interaction with the Women's Budget Group. I have huge respect for their work and have valued it enormously. But I have to make this point bluntly to the committee, that if people are going to complain about the choices I've made, they've got to give me alternatives.
First Minister, I think these organisations would and have offered alternatives, and I don't know that I would characterise it as complaining. I think it's a plea to be involved in the process, which witnesses last week and before have told us was quite opaque and untransparent, and they weren't able to get involved in it. So it's that reassurance that they will have a meaningful conversation with you around the budget going forward.
I'm not really talking about those organisations, I'm talking about Members of Parliament, because Members of Parliament have got hard choices to make. And it's just, frankly, not much use Members of Parliament complaining about the choices I've made and not giving me alternatives. And because I've mapped out, I've been completely transparent with Parliament. There was no obligation of me to come to Parliament on the 7th of September with a statement about the financial position and to set out the range of changes. I could have just done it all in the background, done it in an autumn budget revision. There's very little, you know, public commentary about the autumn budget revisions. I could have just done that, but I didn't. I came to Parliament openly and transparently and shared the problem with Parliament and shared my view of the solution. I think it's then incumbent on Members of Parliament, if they don't like the solutions that I've come up with, to tell me how I should do it differently.
And
in the process, I'll engage with all manner of groups. I'm very happy to listen to it, but with respect, I haven't heard a scintilla of alternative about what I should be doing.
I think that is unfair, particularly given the cost of living plan that the Scottish Labour Party have put to the government on several occasions around this. But I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move to my...
Thank you, Convener. In the 2 minutes I think we've got left, I probably can't have a debate about Barnett formula or budget negotiations between parties, but I wanted to specifically ask, with regards to Social Security Scotland and the management around budgeting around that, about £301 million is operational expenditure, and I wondered what discussions government are having around projected future spend to run the organisation as well.
It's not just about Social Security Scotland, but we have to, across all, and this is implicit in the resource spending review, we have got to very carefully manage the size of the public sector workforce. The public sector workforce grew dramatically during COVID. We have to ensure that that is sustainable on an ongoing basis. So the discussions are ongoing with a range of different, with all the elements of the public sector, frankly, about levels of workforce, the commitments that need to be fulfilled, and the sustainability of budgets. So that will be an ongoing priority. And of course, as budgets are set, the committee will have the opportunity to scrutinise any decisions that flow from that as part of the management of the workforce and its size.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, and to your officials for the very early start this morning. And we will consider the evidence heard and agenda item 4. And I suspend the meeting for a brief comfort break and to change over panels. Thank you very much. Welcome back, and we now turn to our next item of business, which is the second of our pre-budget scrutiny sessions. Our scrutiny focuses on the resource spending review and its impact on poverty, as well as the forthcoming Equalities and Fair Scotland budget statement. This week we are going to hear from two panels, and I welcome to the meeting our first panel, who are both joining us remotely. We have Danny Boyle, who's the Senior Parliamentary and Policy Officer at Bemis, and we have Graham O'Neill, who's the Policy Manager at the Scottish Refugee Council. Thank you both for joining us today. A few housekeeping things before we kick off. If you wait for our broadcasting colleagues to turn your mic on before you start to speak, that would be helpful. I've got the screen up in front of me as well, so if you want to come in on a point, please type R in the chat box and we'll make sure, or wave at me. There's just two of you, so that's quite easy. I can keep track of that. I've got approximately 50 minutes or so for this panel at the moment, and I'm going to invite members to come in and turn. And if members can direct their question to one of the two panellists to kick us off, that would be helpful. So the first theme we have is around about the impact of rising cost of living. And to start us off, I'll bring in Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Natalie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for your submissions that you've submitted previously to the committee. Starting with a fairly general question to open up the discussion this morning, could you advise how the rising cost of living is impacting your organisations and the individuals that you support? And I'll put that first to Danny Boyle. Thank you.
Good morning, committee. Can everybody hear me okay? Thank you very much. Apologies we're not able to attend in person this morning. We have other meetings which we need to attend later on today, but thank you for the opportunity to come along, and always a pleasure to see my colleague Graham O'Neill from the Refugee Council. In short, the impact of the cost of living and inflation is significant, coming off the back of the social, economic and cultural impacts of the pandemic has exacerbated pre-existing inequalities which affected ethnic minority communities in Scotland, and also has a significant impact on even us as organisations within the third sector. We are not any different to the impacts of the cost of living that affect the general population. However, our circumstances and the circumstances of ethnic minority communities in Scotland who would have been more vulnerable to the impacts of the cost of living crisis and the rising inflation mean that these impacts are exacerbated and have significantly more perilous outcomes for people who live in significant social and economic and poverty. So in short, that this is a existential crisis for many people. We saw, when lockdown first occurred in March 2020, we saw a significant increase in destitution. People unable to feed themselves, people unable to look after their families, and that is replicated potentially within this situation. So it's very, very serious.
Thanks, Danny. I think it's important to hear a response from both of the panel members on this question, so I'll turn to Graham for that as well, please.
Thank you, Deputy Convener, and thanks to the committee for inviting us to share evidence today. Yeah, so, I mean, one of the points that Danny made, I just wanted to kind of flow on from, hopefully, which was that, you know, people within the refugee protection systems, particularly the asylum system, are already in what we would describe as deliberate UK state severe poverty. I've articulated that in previous times to the committee, and I touched upon it within the written evidence we've provided. There's been, as we said in our most recent evidence, a long-term degradation of the right to asylum by successive UK governments, but particularly the last few Conservative governments of that right. That sadly reached its new nadir with essentially the extinguishing of that right to seek asylum for the vast majority of refugees through the Nationality and Borders Act that was commenced in terms of its asylum provisions on the 28th of June this year. And what I'm really describing is that there's a systemic socio-economic deprivation of rights to people seeking asylum within the UK, so that, first of all, they are not allowed to work. Secondly, they are provided with what we would, and we don't use this word lightly, but it is objectively a pittance to exist and survive on. So if you're in what we would describe as institutional ex-hotel accommodation, because it's not experienced as hotel, and there's 30,000 people and growing across the 90,000+ people in asylum accommodation across the UK who are in that type of accommodation, then what they receive, people in hotels, 8 local authorities across Scotland at the moment, including in Glasgow, what they receive is £1.24 per day per person. That goes for a child, £1.24 per day per person for that child. I mean, if you look at Universal Credit Standard Allowance, which is a low Social Security floor in our view anyway, I mean, people are way, way below that. That must be around 10-20% of the Universal Credit Standard Allowance. But then if people are in the kind of the more traditional, conventional forms of accommodation within the asylum system, so it's often called in the jargon dispersal accommodation, like flats and within communities, which is better than being an institutional accommodation, then they get £5.83 per person per day. So again, that's, and we've shared this with the committee, that ranges depending upon the demographics within the family, around 47-60% of the value of the social security minimum. So that is a universal credit standard allowance. So I don't say UK state sanctioned poverty pejoratively, I say it factually, because that's what it is. And people can't get out of it because they're denied the right to work, then people are entrapped. And then the consequences is it has for so many groups are the same for people who seek asylum. They're resilient individuals, but they are being tested, and some people can't bear it. So there's been an escalation in loss of life within the asylum system. So that's one of the tragic consequences of this, and we've documented that in our evidence. And we think the conditions for more of that are very much, sadly, still here across the UK. We have, you know, inflation already, you know, moving between 10-11% in the headline rate. But in terms of, as people around the committee will know, and as people who are experiencing poverty know, there's disproportionate impacts of cost of living on the most vulnerable communities already. And then there's particular strands of spending which are essentials, like food, which are higher, frankly, than 10 or 11% in terms of the headline rate. So it's a very, very severe impact. We are terrified, terrified what we're going to be experiencing over this winter within the UK asylum system, including here in Scotland, because people simply do not have enough support already. And that the value of that inadequate support has been eroded still further by the cost of living increases. We think it's a social emergency for the most vulnerable people, including but not only people in the asylum system. And then we are seeing huge turbulence right now, as the Deputy First Minister was articulating, and the committee will be well aware, and that creates even greater uncertainty too. And we do not, as I said in our written evidence, the Home Office do not have the backs of people at this time. Quite the opposite. Often they are pushing people to some of the most dangerous intersections of poverty that are imaginable within the UK. And we urge the committee to play its part, and I'm sure it will, you know, to articulate some of the depth of this poverty to both the UK and particularly to the Home Office, but also to, you know, this to encourage the Scottish Government to take more steps in very difficult circumstances, to be fair to the Scottish Government in terms of its resources. But I think, and I try to articulate this in the kind of 10 actions that we said for the Scottish social inclusion of refugees, we think all of them are within devolved competence. And we think also that a lot of them do three things. They give presence and visibility to refugees across Scotland. So building upon some of the really good work that's been done in relation to Ukrainians. And then secondly, that we protect people. So there's particular recommendations in there about protecting people such as exploitation survivors. But then in doing those 10 actions, we're also saying this will prevent not only harm to people, but we think it could actually prevent escalation of unplanned costs as well through taking those actions. So we've mentioned, and I'll maybe stop there, but we've mentioned some of the particular issues that we would like to see priorities. So the asylum system, and for many others like people in the Afghan bridging hotels, they, in our view, are suffering organised abandonment by the UK state. And we desperately need, in those circumstances, people in Scotland and the Scottish Government and the Scottish communities to come in there and not to abandon, but to be there with people so that they can contribute the way that people who are called refugees often want to do. They're ordinary people that have the extraordinary predicaments, and they've survived them. So, it's grim out there. The honest way to put it, and it's getting grimmer unless there's corresponding mitigation measures put in place. And ideally, the UK state starts to give a toss about the asylum system, because at the moment it's extinguishing it through the Nationality and Borders Act.
Thanks very much, Graeme. Yeah, it doesn't make for easy listening. Now, somehow you managed to answer all three of my questions there in your first response, so I'm just going to give Danny an opportunity to come in on one of my later questions. So, Graeme mentioned the steps that the Scottish Government are taking to increase support, and obviously we've been speaking this morning about the pressures that are facing the Scottish Government, which is working on a fixed budget with limited fiscal powers. But it's clear there's a difficult situation with any changes to one budget having to be taken from another. With that in mind, what would be your priorities going forward for increased support?
To be honest, that's an incredibly difficult question to answer in the present circumstances. Just to rewind slightly, and Graeme, you know, I hope you hear us loud and clear, but Graeme has set out the social reality for human beings living in Scotland who are affected by punitive immigration designations which don't have the appropriate level of support attached to them. We were asked to come to the committee today to get to sort of broadly answer three questions. How will the spending allocations for 23-24 set out in the spending review impact on poverty? If you think there are measures in the resource spending review that could increase poverty, what can be done to prevent this? What level of analysis do you expect to see in the 23-24 Equalities and Fairer Scotland budget? The reality is that circumstances have now outstretched our evidence and our ambition. The reality is that we face a completely unforeseen, in terms of past experience, social impacts on some of our most vulnerable citizens, citizens who, you know, are supposed to be, in theory, protected under the racial provisions of international human rights law, racial provisions of colour, nationality, ethnic, and national origin. And it's very, very clear that that's just not in any way, shape or form being a consideration within the impacts of the UK mini budget or the broader budget. We outlined in our written submission, to the best that we possibly could, where the resource spending review has made some semblance of strategic and specific interventions at minority ethnic communities in Scotland, translation services, pay disparity, mental health provision, disease prevention, and the development of a quality strategy. However, the reality is, in the short term, so from now until spring 2023, these communities and individuals and others across the UK and Scotland face an existential crisis. This is out of hand. You know, we are both myself and Graeme and colleagues across the third sector are extremely stretched in trying to respond to this. People are doing the best they can, but the situation is out of control.
Absolutely. I think I've taken quite a lot of time here, so I'm happy to pass back to the convener just now. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Convener, but thank you both for setting out the reality on the ground as it is at the moment and your concerns going forward. I'm going to bring in my colleague Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Jeremy.
Thank you, and thank you both for coming. I suppose what we're trying to do today is, and I appreciate the situation you are today, but we have to look forward to next year's budget, and we've got to remember it's a Scottish budget. We're here to scrutinise. We're not here to scrutinise UK. We're the Scottish Parliament. We're responsible for decisions made here by our Parliament and by our government. So going forward, Danny, in regard to the budget for next year, which is what we're looking at today, not at the moment, what priorities would you want the Scottish Government to do for the next year's financial budget?
Thanks for the question, Jeremy. And I don't think we can ignore the fact that the UK budget and the Scottish budget are inextricably linked, and decisions made at Westminster have a direct impact on our fiscal independence or how we choose to spend our money in Scotland. Very singularly focused on the Scottish budget and what we have. We have called for a considerable period, but a much more strategic intervention with regards to race equality. So it's be beneficial for the committee and other duty bearers, public, more broadly. What are we talking about when we're talking about race? The positive duty within the Equality Act to take into consideration the impacts of decisions made by public services of our colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin. In Scotland, they are multi-generational communities, they are newer migrant communities, they are refugees, they are asylum seekers, they are a variation of circumstances. And we know, I mean, that the Parliament has heard relentlessly across multiple committees of the continual structural inequality which affect these people from different racial provisions. So we outlined, within the resource spending review, there's some specific minor mitigations, as I said, around translation services and others. But what we have called for and what would be highly, highly beneficial moving forward would be something to replicate the sort of intervention which was made with the Rural Communities Transformation Scheme. And we've called for the Race Equality Framework and the action plans and the multiple policy levers which need to be influenced in order to transform that is for a race equality transformational investment scheme and the fiscal budget to achieve that would have to be considered and reflected. So there's things which we're not doing, which we could do. However, all of that is bound by the present reality.
I'm done. Thank you.
Annie, I'll now move to a question from Pam Duncan-Glancy. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you both for the evidence you've given so far and also the evidence you've submitted in advance. I have to say most of my questions have been covered in terms of the cost of living questions that I had, with the exception of one, which is so thank you for all of that. But how have your organisations been affected? So as well as your membership, but also your organisation has been affected by the cost of living crisis. Oh, sorry. Sorry, Convener, forgive me. I'll start with Graeme, if that's okay.
Significantly, and thanks, Pam, for the question. Because we're working, like Danny and many other third sector bodies, we're working at the front line of people who are already have to make survival decisions rather than having choices. And that the systems that were in place for them are trying to come back and re-emerge after the COVID pandemic restrictions have eased, including for ourselves as a frontline organisation providing services to refugees. There's been a real challenge for us to try and make sure that we can still have the same quality and breadth of contact with people. So we put in now a national helpline for all people who are seeking international protection, who are in Scotland and are looking to try and access. But that's about signposting, you know, it's about getting that contact, getting details, and then signposting. And of course, that signposting can lead to and will lead to us taking on the case and escalating and leading the case, especially in relation to people trying to access the asylum system itself. But that's been an important part of our learning, is to try and make ourselves more accessible in this kind of post-COVID phase that we're in. We also, as you would hope and expect, are now starting to go out and about and are working very much within where people are actually at. So if it's people through our Afghan Citizens Information Service, and then we have some outreach work that we do through our integration workers with Afghan families within the bridging hotels in Scotland. We're doing the same as much as we can, because there's a lot of people in terms of the Ukraine residents who are in hotels as well as elsewhere. And we're also doing the same as much as we can within, for want of a better way of putting it, the asylum institutional accommodation, such as there's a particular place which you think is highly inappropriate in Glasgow, but that many families in the asylum system have been put into, and we think is deeply inappropriate accommodation for families and also pregnant women and new mothers who are in there. So we're kind of re-emerging and reconfiguring, it's a bit of a kind of pretentious term, but we're reconfiguring our services to try and make sure we get the same quality and breadth of provision. But one of the things that I didn't really get a chance to say earlier, I just wanted to say in terms of priorities, and this comes through some of the work that we're doing now, is we would really like to see the Scottish Government build refugees into its Child Poverty Action Plan, working specifically local authorities and health boards' legal duty to prepare and review on an annual basis its Child Poverty Action Plans. That's a specific thing that flows out of one of the provisions that we mentioned in our 10 actions that we submitted to the committee around poverty. And maybe ask later on if it is, I'll park it, but there's definitely an issue around concessionary travel as well, which is an absolutely essential measure, in our opinion, and many other campaigners' provision, that would be life-changing for many people in the asylum process. We would like to see it for all low-income groups, because we think transport and access to transport is a social justice issue, and especially in a cost-of-living social emergency, and it has important wider positive effects, not only mental well-being, but also in terms of employment opportunities and being able to commute and childcare and all of the rest of it. For people in the asylum process, going back to what I was mentioning earlier, who can't work, who don't get access to the mainstream social security, so Scottish Child Payment, for example, then those individuals, it would be a transformative measure. Now, we have been disappointed with some of our discussions with Transport Scotland, specifically in relation to towards a national pilot of that type of scheme to build up the evidence for inclusion to national entitlement card. But I just wanted to flag up those two, because these are two issues that have really hit us very clearly since we've re-emerged from COVID and we've started to get out and about. Child poverty and poverty more broadly, and the cost of living social emergency, and related to that is transport, and specifically access to free bus travel. And we really want the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland to revisit that over the coming year for the new budget, because the demand that will come from people in the asylum process, and the Welsh Refugee Council pilot showed this, will be very strong. So we actually think it would help mitigate some of the Scottish Government's rationale for saying we needed to reduce some concessionary travel because the demand wasn't there. For people in the asylum process, I can guarantee, and the Welsh Refugee Council stuff shows this, the demand will overwhelmingly be there, and it will have wider positive benefits for people. So it has a significant partner organisation, but we are, like many other third sector bodies, working with refugees very much out and about across Scotland, and it is across Scotland now, not only in Glasgow. given, as I said in our written evidence, that we have protection populations across the country, and that will continue.
Thank you for that, Graeme. Danny, are you able to respond as well, and in particular on the impact of the cost of living crisis on your organisation?
Thanks very much. I would like to address two points. First point on the direct impact on our organisation, and the second point just responding to Graeme on the Child Poverty Action Plan and what could potentially should be our ambition with regards to devolved social security powers to mitigate issues such as no recourse to public funds. First of all, on the cost of living crisis on our organisation, so I'm going to take the opportunity to outline the reality for Bemis and Bemis staff and employees and our members. This is replicated, and this may be replicated across the third sector. So, ironically, we work within a domain which is equalities and human rights. Our core funding comes from the Scottish Government, from the Equalities and Human Rights budget. And that budget has been largely stagnant for over a decade. I think it's increased by maybe 1 or 2 million between 2010 to 2022, which, as we know, would that effectively be a significant real terms budget cut for people who are working on the front line to support communities through, you know, long-term race equality ambitions, asylum processes, into a pandemic, now into a cost of living crisis. So, in terms of the third sector and my colleagues, this is a largely non-unionised workforce. It's a third sector workforce. There is no immediate union you can join to collectively bargain for progression and, you know, all of the, you know, the sort of things which we see positively coming from teachers' unions and railway workers' unions. And these are people working on the front line with regards to equalities and human rights, and working with some of the most vulnerable people and challenges in Scottish society. So the cost of living crisis for people in that environment, who are employed in that environment, is significant. There is no clear pathway to increasing people's wages or, you know, keeping up with the cost of living crisis, because there's no mechanism for collective bargaining. And that will have an impact on everybody's, you know, motivation, their mental health, you know, all of the things which we know are affected when people are put into financial hardship, and that obviously then has an impact on people's work. So that's worthy of the committee being aware of that and noting that, and maybe the question from the Scottish Government how it intends to increase the Equalities and Human Rights budget for core funding for Equalities and Human Rights organisations to reflect the cost of living crisis. At present, ourselves and other compatriot organisations have 6 months funding. So we have funding now from October until March. Again, that's you know, sort of goes against the principles of giving people stability and recognition, and, you know, being able to plan progressively for the future. So, you know, these budget decisions not only impact they impact everybody. They impact people who need our services, and they impact people providing the services. That's the reality of where we are at the moment. In terms of the broader ambitions that could be progressed via the, as Graeme acknowledged, via the Child Poverty Action Plan and the provision of social security in a devolved setting, we have been clear, and we put it in our written submission, around about a future for social security in Scotland. That we need to have a much clearer understanding of how many children, especially, but how many people are affected by the punitive immigration designation, no recourse to public funds in Scotland, and how do we use our devolved powers and our devolved social security to bypass immigration restrictions in order to provide support to people who require it via education, devolved, via health, devolved, and make sure that everybody, as much as possibly can be encapsulated into our social security system for those who need it most.
Thank you for that. I appreciate it. I have no further questions at this point.
Thank you very much. We'll head into our next set of questions, and I'll hand over to my colleague Emma Roddick, who will be followed by Miles Briggs. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. My questions are for yourself, Danny. We heard earlier from the Deputy First Minister around issues with actions here very much depending on when and whether we get money from decisions made down south and how much money that is. The UK fiscal announcement last week will, of course, have massive implications in many ways. What's your take on the human rights implications of it?
It's beyond comprehension. It's we can only tell the directors. We don't know what the answer is going to be. What the impacts are going to be. We saw the closest thing that we have as a comparison is the immediate impact of lockdown in March 2020, and we saw an exponential growth and destitution and isolation and mental health impacts on ethnic minority communities in Scotland, and particularly on those who suffer what we would describe. Again, Graeme talked earlier, it's not a personal opinion, it's a fact, of law, but it's an institutionally racist immigration system. Article 1 of the International Convention, the elimination of all forms of racial discrimination, outlines clearly that preventing access to the same level of support that the general population or other people have on the basis of colour, nationality, ethnic or national origin is a form of institutional racism, and that's what our immigration designations are, and particularly via the implementation of no recourse to public funds. But in the coming period, and again, what I outlined earlier is reality has now surpassed evidence and expectation. This is an existential threat to people's lives. We wrote to the Secretary of State for Scotland and we wrote to the First Minister, and I'll just repeat what we outlined, and some of this is complicated because it cuts across reserved and devolved powers. So those who will be impacted by the mini-budget and the cost of living and inflation are those subjected to no recourse to public funds. Disproportionate number of ethnic minority people in precarious employment, zero hours contract, small business holders and students, asylum seekers and newly arrived refugee families and individuals, elderly ethnic minority people, single parents and mothers. And the outcomes of that will be people will struggle to feed themselves and their families. People and families will struggle to keep warm, leading to an increase in significant ill health. People will suffer significant mental health burden and trauma. People will fall into significant and irretrievable debt affecting them and their children's life chances and future. Most vulnerable through ill health and frailty may not get through the winter, and isolation and loneliness will increase significantly. That's the reality at present at what we're facing. There's minor mitigation being put in place by UK and Scottish Government. It won't be enough. So that's the impact of budget statements which don't take into consideration people's lives, which are human rights.
Thank you. For that comprehensive answer. The priorities of the spending review here, particularly the ones around child poverty and the climate crisis, these are things that this committee has heard before have a particular effect on minority ethnic communities, particularly those who are single parent. Budgets are about decisions and prioritising. Do you feel that the prioritisation of these issues is something that you support? And is it a contrast with last week's announcement?
The prioritisation of protecting children and parents and families will always be supported. However, and it'd be beneficial also to hear Graeme's position on this and the Scottish Refugee Council's expertise, people subjected to no recourse to public funds and punitive immigration designations, who are in theory supposed to be protected by the UK / Scottish Government's signature and incorporation of the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, are not appropriately reflected within those policy decisions, and we covered it within our written submission. Those catch-all, you know, increasing the £25 to £25 child payment will, of course, include some, or maybe even the vast majority of ethnic minority families in Scotland who are incredibly diverse in and of themselves, but I won't cover everybody. And we're sort of banging our heads off a brick wall talking about this issue and no recourse to public funds, and those who are most vulnerable, most susceptible to destitution, who were acutely affected by lockdown and not able to access self-isolation support grants and all of the mitigation measures that were put in place by UK and Scottish Government, they are not included in that. So they will continue to be isolated and facing significant and existential threats. And again, in our written submission, we put forward ideas about how we share information from the DWP and from Social Security Scotland to ensure that everybody who can access something can access something. And that's not in place at the moment. But there's also there's people who are not caught, who are not, don't have, there's people in Scotland who do not have access to that support, and we need to know who they are. We know it anecdotally because we speak to them, we engage with them, but we don't know it as a state. We don't know it as the mechanisms of the state, and the state is supposed to be there to protect these people, regardless of their immigration designation, and we don't have that at present.
Understand this? Yep. Thank you for that, Danny. What I'm going to ask is, we've got questions to come from Miles Briggs and Pam Duncan-Glancy, and in the interest of time, if they could roll their questions one after the other, and we'll finish up with Pam. So, Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us. I wanted to ask two questions, one with regards to partner organisations within local government especially, and not just within this current budget year, but previous ones where local government have seen cuts to their budget, a decision by Scottish ministers to do that. And in what way would a flat cash allocation to local authorities impact on your organisation and the services which local government help deliver? Graham, do you want to come in on that?
Thanks, Miles. Just before I answer that, I just wanted to just follow on very briefly from what Danny was saying there about no recourse to public funds, that we would have hoped and expected to see no recourse to public funds because it's such a broad and highly restrictive regime within the budget statement, and we would look to see that there next year, because that's people who are, when we use the phrase most vulnerable, they are in the most vulnerable socioeconomic and legal predicament, and they literally have nothing often. So, and that has repercussions, including onto local authorities. Try to segue over to local authorities. I think, you know, I mean, I'm not an accountant, I'm not a technical expert with finance, but I suppose, like, to me, I read that flat cash in terms of jargon would strike me as basically, you know, in a cost of living inflationary environment is a kind of cut, essentially, you know, not one that MD would want to, but in an inflationary environment, it can result in real terms cuts, and nobody would want that. And I'm sure the Scottish Government would be the same in that. In terms of the impacts on that, then it does have an impact in third sector and communities, because the third sector is there partly because, as charities, were there to be much more accessible, to be less rule bound by legislation, etc., to be there for the people who are there. But we can only do that, you know, if we have enough resources ourselves to do that. And this is where it's really important that there is partnership, or at least effective liaison, between local authorities and third sector organisations on the provision of the key things that need to happen. You know, so no recourse to public funds is actually, you know, sadly a good example of this. There's been a lot of work done in Scotland over the last few years around Fair Way Scotland, as a national initiative, housing rights organisations, refugee rights organisations, it's essentially working to try and apply housing first principles to people who are no recourse to public funds, right? That's what it's trying to do. It's bloody difficult because, you know, no recourse to public funds wipes away entitlement to the key social security and housing homelessness provisions for people who are subject to no recourse to public funds. But if you have partnerships, as we've tried to do in Glasgow, particularly where between RSLs and third sector bodies, really great organisations like Safe in Scotland, for example, who are a charity but have reached strategic relationships with RSLs and others for the provision of accommodation to people who are, in this case, refused asylum seekers who are seeking to re-access the asylum procedure. The savings that makes, to me, are incalculable, not only in mental health deterioration, but also in terms of trying to prevent people, prevent unplanned costs on local authorities and others. So we really need to come together across Scotland, local authorities and charities, because the facts are that, you know, we've got a highly unstable macroeconomic environment. You know, there is very little, from what we can see, visibility of vulnerable groups within the room in decisions that are currently getting made at the UK level. And there's going to be, and there are casualties, has been the main theme of this evidence, as Danny's articulated particularly. And unless local authorities and third sector bodies work really closely together, then there's going to be more risks of people not only suffering significant mental health deterioration and then all the costs that come from that, but a higher risk of exploitation from organised crime groups as well, because if society pushes people to the margins, then they are potentially met by organised crime groups. And then that can make community safety much more of a challenge, because organised crime, of course, gets involved in multiple criminal activities. So when it, I suppose the conclusion, the key point is that if we don't come together locally, and then what is actually going to happen is much greater costs on individuals affected, and there'll be a higher number of people, and then also on the services trying to meet them. And that is why it's so important that the next budget and the Scottish budget has no recourse to public funds and has clear visibility of people in the asylum process and wider minority ethnic communities visible in it, because we didn't really see that within the budget, you know, when we looked at documents. And that, obviously, that's why we said in our recommendations 1, 2 and 3, I think it was, in our Scottish actions, about they were all about trying to give visibility to people in the policy making process, because that in itself, if it's done reasonably well, can prevent, you know, people falling into the predicaments that then local authorities and third sector bodies have to come together on. So I hope that's helpful in terms of an answer.
Thank you for that. I know we've got very limited time. So my second question before I bring you in, Danny, was with regards to what engagement you've had with government around discussing these priorities. I think we as a committee have heard loud and clear your ask around people with no recourse to public funds, but what sort of engagement have you had with government on that as well?
I mean, we've had some engagement around issues around child poverty and issues around social security. We think that there needs to be, as we said in our suggested 10 actions, a kind of real ramping up of awareness and education around entitlement for those provisions, because they're really important. And I think the other area that we've not had engagement in, and it will be touched on, I'm sure, in the following session, is, I just want to emphasise it, is housing. Housing needs to be much more prominent, we think, in the next budget, because we see the most vulnerable communities, socioeconomic and legal communities, who are frankly put into, across the UK, so not only in Scotland, into, you know, what is not suitable accommodation, and often it's privately owned accommodation by kind of like big landlords who are taking public monies, etc., to provide what is actually not good accommodation that anybody would sign up to. So there's a strategic issue around the availability of social housing that we would really emphasise. And in many ways, what we've seen in relation to the Afghan populations and the Ukrainian populations, is I think it's across the UK it's not only in Scotland, to show the fragility of the lack of availability of appropriate social housing. And we think that that is something, if I don't get a chance to say any more, is something that does need to be prioritised and given prevalence in the next future budget measures.
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks, Kamina. If Danny doesn't want to come in on that, happy to hand back.
Yep, I'll hand over to Pam, and if Danny wants to come in and maybe wrap that up into to the answers to Pam, that would be helpful. Pam?
Thank you for that. And my questions actually were around the area of the effects of the flat cash allocation to local authorities. So, I'm keen to know what the impact, in addition to what you've already covered, what specifically will be the impact in areas like, for example, the employability cuts? And I appreciate the point about employability and the intersections with the people you represent, but I'm keen to know if you think that there are any implications of that. And then further, my last question for this session is around what would you like to see the government do to engage your organisation? So not specifically about the actions they take, but how would you like them to work with you going forward in budgeting processes?
Let me start with Danny.
Thanks very much. Just to cover Miles' question and Pam's question as succinctly as possible, and also to provide the committee and listeners, the general public more broadly, with sort of key information around about the infrastructure of what we're talking about. So in 2016, we launched, along with the Scottish Government and partners, the Race Equality Framework. For Scotland, 2016 to 2030, and over each parliamentary cycle, that framework and its overarching ambitions are distilled into what are called the Race Equality Action Plans. So the last one was 17 to 21. Then obviously we were interrupted by the pandemic and everyone focused on that naturally. And now we're moving into this parliamentary cycle again. Point being that the Race Equality Action Plan has over 80 action points across six key policy themes. Some of them are responsibility of Scottish Government, but the vast majority are the responsibility of other duty bearers, and a significant amount are the responsibility of local authorities. So we have reiterated this continuously at other committees and in our meetings, but the current budgetary allocations at both a national and local level, local government level, are not compatible with the Scottish Government's Race Equality Framework or the Action Plan. And the stark truth is, and this will be exacerbated by this present cost of living crisis, and we know that budgets are finite, if we continue on this path and trajectory, we'll observe small, non-impactful symbolic gains, while austerity and recession, enhanced and exacerbated by COVID and the cost of living crisis, will weld a generation of ethnic minority youth and community further systemic inequalities. That's the truth. there's no other way to put it out there. Despite all of us working as best we possibly can, despite best intentions of government and ministers, that's the reality. That's where we are at the moment.
Thank you for that, Danny. That was really bleak but clear. Thank you. Graham, do you have anything to add on the process point? Or Danny, in fact, if you want to finish, and then we can bring Graham back in after that.
So the process of budgeting should follow up what is called a human rights-based approach, a panel process. So it should be about participation, accountability, non-discrimination, equality, legality. The panel process in terms of budgeting priorities should be hardwired into everything that we do, and it should be ongoing, and it should have a degree of flexibility to respond to the crises which we're facing at the moment. And the truth is, like the pandemic, our systems, the way we conduct our business, are not capable of responding in real time appropriately to the circumstances that we face. And we should all, government, local government, third sector, everybody, take account of that and think about how we learn from this.
Thank you. Graham, did you have anything further to add to those points?
Yeah, I promise it'll be brief. So I think lived experience is a current term for people who are at the front end of, you know, the bad stuff. That would be my main recommendation, is that alongside the panel being applied, the panel approach being applied all year round, is that we really put lived experience at the heart of it. And we do that not because we think it's in principle the right thing to do, because in principle it is, of course, the right thing to do, but also because if objectively it gives you excellent insights into what actually it is like, and then what actually can be done to overcome it. So in other words, it's not a kind of charitable thing only either to do it. It's a deeply important ingredient, but under a neglected part of effective policy making, which should be about what's the script here, what's actually happening in terms of how people are managing the issues, and then how can we overcome it. It needs to be really at the heart of the process. And of course, we've said, the first 3 points of our 10 actions are all about process, they're about inclusion and involvement of refugees within policy making. And all we are doing there is what people within the gender equality movement, the disabilities equalities movement, the race equality movement have done for decades and decades, which is basically trying to get visibility and awareness of the experiences of groups into the mainstream, so-called the kind of mainstream of the lifeblood of life, social, economic life, and political life. That's what we're trying to do. And we think the budget process should be setting that as its target. And that's especially given that, you know, the truth is the Deputy First Minister said, options are being restricted, you know, through wider macroeconomic pressures. So it's all the more important that people come together. But we need to put lived experience at the heart of this. It's not just the right thing to do in principle. It will deliver a lot of benefits for the kind of like the accuracy, the precision of effective policy. So you have people with the lived experience rather than people that be much more at the kind of like at these types of sessions and in the budget processes, because the people will tell you much more useful things often than people who have got job titles around policy manager or whatever within third sector bodies, because they're experiencing it and actually have got unique insights that, you know, ones they'd rather not have, because often it's bad stuff, but they've got it, and that should be at the front kind of style. So yeah, that's what I would say for the budget process, as well as more generally.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to both of you for joining us this morning and giving your evidence, and also for your written submissions. And just to let you know that the committee did undertake human rights training over the summer, and that the panel principles are forefront in our mind, and we think that that's a key way that we can ensure that we do our scrutiny work to the best that we can do. So I will suspend briefly for a changeover of witnesses. If we can come back in approximately 5 minutes, that would be helpful. Thanks, Graham and Danny. Thank you. Definitely. Welcome back, everyone. And I welcome to the meeting our third panel of this morning. We have Gordon McRae, who's the Assistant Director of Shelter Scotland, who is joining us in the room. And we also have Frank McKillop, who's the Head of Policy and Research at Enable Scotland, who's joining us remotely. And I've just reminded members before we started that we can't direct all the questions to Gordon because he's in the hot seat in the room. We have to remember that we have Frank online. So as always, I'll ask members to direct their questions to one of the witnesses to start us off. And then if the other witness wants to come in, and Frank, if you just give me a wave, I'll make sure that I'm keeping my eye on you there. And if you give our colleagues in broadcasting a second to turn your microphone on before you start, that would be helpful. So thanks for your written submissions, and thank you both for making time to come in today. And Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn is going to start us off with some questions around about the impact of the rising cost of living. Natalie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. So, yeah, I just want to start off with a kind of fairly general question to open up the discussion this morning. If you could tell us how the rising cost of living is impacting your organisations and the individuals that you support. And I'll go to Gordon first, and I'll turn to Frank after. Thank you.
Thank you. It's safe to say we've never seen a time like this. The cost of living crisis is accelerating the depth of homelessness, the experience of bad housing in Scotland, and the most recent annual homelessness statistics shows just how that is impacting in the communities we are here to serve. And it wasn't lightly that we described the last homelessness statistics as demonstrating that Scotland's housing and homelessness system is on the brink of failure. There is a very real bubble of people trapped in temporary accommodation. Homelessness in Scotland is largely indoors, not outdoors, but that shouldn't hide it from our gaze and our understanding. So the cost of living crisis, as we're calling it now, is not necessarily a new phenomenon for a lot of the communities that we're talking about. The ability to access vital services, people with multiple and complex needs, is getting harder. It's harder even still for people without the support and capacity to actually access those services at a point of crisis. But it's also beginning to impact on people who just quite simply need a home. The homelessness problem is relatively simple. We need more houses, and that's why Shelter Scotland, we a couple of weeks ago published our proposal of a Scottish Housing Emergency Action Plan, because we think there is more that can be done here in Scotland. We can't be immune from the trends coming from elsewhere, but there are different choices we can make that can improve the lives of people here.
Thank you very much. Can I turn now to Frank, please, for the same question?
Yes, thanks, Deputy Convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting Enable to make a submission. For us, the impact, I think, is twofold. It's on our members and the people we work for, disabled people in the communities around Scotland, and the organisational impact, I think, is primarily felt through our workforce. So turning to the people we work for, firstly, it's well documented that disabled people are among the most at risk of poverty in any circumstances. I think some of the most comprehensive research that has been done on that was by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation back in 2016. Just some of the headline findings from that 31% of people in a family with a disabled person live in poverty, 44% of disabled young adults live in poverty, 66% of disabled people who live alone live in poverty, and perhaps the most worrying at the moment, 38% of households with a disabled person experience fuel poverty. That was back in 2016. We know that COVID exacerbated that yet further, and we know that the current energy crisis and cost of living crisis once again will be falling disproportionately on disabled people. So it's something we have serious concerns about, the impact on disabled people. Organisationally, I think the biggest impact we're feeling is through our workforce. Enable is one of Scotland's largest social care charities. We employ roughly 2,500 people. 2,200 of them are frontline social care workers in communities all over Scotland. And as we know, the social care workforce has often not been one of the better paid professions in Scotland. We have got to a better position where pay, certainly everyone at Enable, is paid substantially above the current real living wage. The Scottish Government had agreed last year to come in with an increased funded pay rate of £10.50 an hour, 60p an hour above what was then the real living wage. But we nevertheless know that cost of living impacts are hitting our workforce quite hard. The Living Wage Foundation has just this month announced the new real living wage of £10.90 an hour, a 10.1% uplift, obviously reflective of the rate of inflation at the present time. So there's certainly a significant challenge there. The Living Wage Foundation has recognised that pay in social care, pay across the sector, has to be higher than it is. And we really need the Scottish Government to react to that, because otherwise, you know, the impact, as we know, excellent social care is delivered by the workforce. And unless we have a workforce who feels secure in their employment, who feels secure in their home life, that they can afford all their bills and can bring their whole selves to work when they're supporting the people in our communities, then our whole social care system would be at risk. So it's vitally important that frontline pay in social care is addressed, and that's certainly something, you know, from Enable, you know, we're very proud that we are an award-winning living wage accredited employer, but it's certainly something we need to see a swift reaction from the Scottish Government to implement an uplift in social care funded pay to reflect the new real living wage, and indeed significantly beyond the real living wage, not only because of the cost of living pressures, but also because of the recruitment and retention pressures that remain a significant factor in the social care sector.
Thank you very much both for your responses to that. I suppose following on from that then, Frank, the Scottish Government have set out certain steps they're taking to support people through this crisis, but we've been speaking this morning about the extreme pressures facing the Scottish Government because of working on a fixed budget with limited fiscal powers, and any change to one budget has to be found from another. So given these constraints, are you supportive of the steps that the Scottish Government have taken so far, and what would be your priorities going forward through this? And I'll turn to Frank and then I'll bring Gordon in. Thank you.
I think what we welcome, and again, I think even looking at the resource spending review, I think as other witnesses have said today, a lot of that has been sort of torn up by recent events as the economy has moved quite significantly over the last few weeks. What we have welcomed is the maintenance of funding in health and social care, but that has been held up. The increased funding there is not being impacted by the immediate cuts that have been brought about. We do, however, have concerns. We note that the Scottish Fiscal Commission, even at the time of the resource spending review, noted that inflationary pressures meant that the 10% uplift to health and social care by 2026-27 was essentially a 1% uplift in real terms. That predated some of the spiralling inflation that we've seen. So I'm sort of worried to see what the impact there is going to be. And I think, you know, by welcoming upholding health and social care investment, we recognise a big part of that has to be the NHS's COVID recovery. But social care has to have enhanced funding. You know, I've mentioned just on the basic level, frontline pay. But I think as the ambition that the Scottish Government has, that we very much welcome to implement a national care service, we know that that's going to require significant funding. The Independent Review of Adult Social Care in Scotland, led by Derek Feely, estimated the cost of a national care service under his proposed model would be an additional £660 million a year. And that was based on frontline pay at £950. So if we project frontline pay, you know, hopefully it's somewhere £1,150 or higher, you're looking at £860 million a year. And by the time we get to 2026, it's not unreasonable to say that would be over £1 billion a year that would have to be found in addition for social care. So I think that, you know, while we, and again, I've listened to the Deputy First Minister this morning, entirely appreciate the frustrations that he has about the limits that he has to work within. We certainly welcome that health and social care remains prioritised, but there is greater investment that's required there. And I think the second strand of that, in terms of employability, we did have some concerns about, needless to say, about some of the cuts that are proposed to employability and the impact that could potentially have on disabled people. But again, just to specifically focus on what we welcome in it, it was recognising health and social care as a high priority for the coming years.
Thanks very much. That's very helpful. Could I turn now to Gordon, please?
Thanks. I mean, we very much agree with the Scottish Government's stated objectives when it comes to housing and homelessness. It's a rights-based system. It's about ensuring access to more social housing. There's cash be made available through discretionary housing payments in the resource spending review and recent announcements around tenants grant fund. We very much welcome the reversal of the decision to make that a loan fund originally and turn it into grants. But we also recognise that it's not touching the sides of the scale of the problem, and it's quite an atomised set of budget pots. You know, you're trying to actually understand, well, where is the money going into prevention? Where is the money going in through local government cuts? How is that investment? How do we know what's actually having an impact? You know, the welcome initiatives like Housing First, which require quite a significant cultural shift within local authority homelessness services. It's actually really difficult to understand how much money is going where, what's the benefit of it, what should we do more of and what should we do less of. What we come back to is when the Scottish Government and COSLA jointly created the Ending Homelessness Together plan, there was an estimate of what the transition funding was required to do that. And the available cash fell a long way short of that. Now, no doubt policymakers would say, well, there's a negotiation to be had, there's work to be done with local authorities about what's core funding, what's transitionary. But what we see are the results, and the results are a record number of children in temporary accommodation with a reducing prospect of permanent housing. We see more and more people being placed in hotel accommodation, in unsuitable accommodation, based on the standards that are coming forward. And we recognise that local authorities have been asked to do more with less, and that's not a sustainable position. And we have to have an honest conversation about what is the priority. For us at Shelter Scotland, we think the priority should be ensuring that we drive forward with the increasing access to social, affordable, secure housing. We think that can be done by reprofiling some of the funds to encourage more buying in the open market. We think that should be done at a national level, not just making a bid pot available to local authorities, but actually setting an objective. Something Audit Scotland criticised the last affordable house building programme for was not having any objective beyond just the numerical target. We think that the objective should be what the research we commissioned with Chartered Institute of Housing and Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, to reduce affordable housing need in Scotland. That's a measurable impact of the levels of housing poverty. That's not a stated goal. The only stated goal is 110,000 by 10 years. Housing to 2040 did state a midpoint target of 50,000. That's no longer a target. We need to know what the plan is. We need to know how it's going to be delivered. And we need to know how that will lift people out of poverty, out of temporary accommodation, and give our youngsters a real chance for a future.
Thank you very much, Gordon. Thank you both. Pass back to the convener. Thanks.
Thanks, Deputy Convener. And we'll hand over to Pam Duncan-Glancy now for her first set of questions. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you both. Thank you again for the submissions that you've sent in advance, but also for the questions you've answered so far. In a similar vein to my colleague, Natalie Dawn, I wondered if you could set out, and if it's okay, I'll start with Frank on this particular question, and I'll come back to yourself, Gordon. I wonder if you could set out some of the realities of what disabled people are having to do in the crisis that is the cost of living crisis, and in particular around fuel poverty and how it's affecting what they do on a daily basis.
Thanks. I think what we are seeing from among our members who interact with us and a lot of the community groups that we run around Scotland, I think probably the most heartbreaking that we hear is often people having to restrict the amount of care and support hours that they are contracting, and that's where, as we know, there are charges that are applied still to a lot of social care that people access beyond the budget they've been allocated through social work. We are hearing people are having to cut back on care and support hours that they would pay for in addition to that budgeted allowance, and that has just a direct impact on how active and engaged they can be in their community, which again is absolutely the antithesis of really what charities like Enable believe in, in terms of supporting disabled people to be fully involved and included in their community. Again, I think our fears certainly are heading into the Scottish winter. We certainly welcome that the UK government has acted to, I think, stem the worst of the projected spiralling of fuel costs. I think the freezing at least helps with that, but we should never lose sight of, you know, from October 1st, the price of fuel for pretty much every household in Britain will still go up. And will still go up reasonably substantially. and that will impact people in particular, and as we know, poorer people, people living in poverty, and as we know, that disproportionately impacts disabled households. They are more likely to have prepaid meters, they are more likely to be on the more expensive methods of paying for energy, and that, of course, reflects the amount you use at that time. So where there might perhaps be a bit of shielding from the worst of the impacts, when payment is based on usage, then those individual bills that people are facing over the winter months could be quite horrific, even with the capping that the UK government has introduced. So that certainly is our concern, and I think it's the biggest, you know, and we may get to that horrific situation in the winter where people are choosing not to heat their homes, or are cutting back on the amount of food that they eat and stuff like that, and that is certainly something that we fear. But the immediate impact we're already seeing from the cost of living crisis is people, unfortunately, cutting back on their hours of support and being less active in the community as a result of that.
Thank you very much, Frank. And as someone who uses social care, I can't imagine what that must be like for people, or I can't, you know, not to have it and not to be able to rely on it. So that's it's tragic. The Scottish Government has said that they're doing everything that they can for disabled people and to help them through this cost of living crisis. Do you agree? And do you think there's anything more they could be doing?
I think it's always that frustration that we always want more to be done. And again, I hear the Deputy First Minister sort of his frustration at the limitations he's working in and the challenge to others to come up with alternatives. I think where we would certainly like to see some more action is around care charging. We know there is the ambition as part of the National Care Service that care charging would be abolished. We would certainly like to see that happen. We'd like to see that come through in the bill in its final form. But we can't wait 4 years. That this is a real impact on people now. So I think certainly if there were measures possible to remove care charging for disabled people, I think that would certainly make an immediate impact. I wish there was limitless money to make that happen, and I appreciate those pressures, but I think as a priority, you know, if we believe in the human right for people to be included, you know, if we think of the UN Chartered on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities and Article 19 about the right to be included in your community. If we really believe in that, if that's important to us as a country, then we have to find a way of making that a reality. And I think certainly ensuring people have all the support they require to be fully engaged and active in their community is an important step that can be taken. And again, I think as others have said, politics is about decisions and priorities. And our view is that should be a priority for any government.
Thank you for that really, really clear answer. Thank you, Frank. Gordon, I was hoping to hear from you a little bit about the impact of the cost of living crisis on your members in particular, but also your thoughts around the impact of the rent freeze and what difference you think that will make to people in Scotland.
In terms of the impact on the people we work with, first of all, the impact falls disproportionately on people with protected characteristics. So we know that one of the big choke points in the Scottish housing system is a lack of larger properties. We know there's a correlation. I wouldn't want to put any stronger than that because the research doesn't really exist. But there's definitely a correlation with households from first and second generation immigrant background, refugee status, but also in people with both physical and mental impairments, and the need to provide adaptive accommodation is a real struggle. And actually, there's a live legal challenge right now around what the expectations we have on public bodies to meet the housing support needs when they're assessed, and that isn't happening consistently. So we know that the overall availability of properties, but also the availability of cash and the ability of public bodies to go and secure accommodation in the open market is very limited, and that falls disproportionately. We also have never truly done the gendered analysis of the Ending Homelessness Together framework that has been long promised and I think is now well overdue. I think in terms of the, remember the second half of your question, are the Scottish Government doing everything they can? No, otherwise we wouldn't have published an action plan setting out what else we think they could be doing. There's a range of options available. The rent freeze for us is good news in terms of it stopping more people becoming homeless, but it has a relatively marginal impact because of the effect of housing benefit on people at the lowest end. And we also know that many social landlords had a relatively modest plans for the coming year. Not universally, but you know, we want to see rents as low as practically possible. But we also need to understand the unintended consequences of that. And at a time when the revenue books of social landlords is also where they seek funding to, you know, from borrowing to meet their net zero, you know, carbon targets, but also to build the new social homes. Any compound impact of a reduction that's unfunded could risk choking off the new supply of social housing. So for us, the question around the rent freeze is we just don't know, does it have additional resource attached to mitigate that impact? We don't know. We understand it maybe is for an initial 6 months, but there is an interest in having the powers for two subsequent six-month periods. So actually, is that forecast available, the financial forecast in terms of housing benefit and revenue? There's, you know, as a housing and homelessness charity, it seems almost churlish to be kind of asking questions about something that's reducing the housing costs of people. But what we know in housing is you pull the thread in one bit, and it starts to unfurl somewhere else. So we very much welcome anything that keeps people in the home that they have, but there are many unanswered questions, and there wasn't really much engagement before the announcement. We're now the best part of 3 weeks in. We are getting a lot of phone calls from very worried tenants who don't know are they supposed to pay the rent increase that's come through since the 6th of September. What are their rights? And we just can't answer that just now. So it's a bit of a guddle, but we're, you know, the intention is one that we share, but we just need to know the detail.
Thank you for that. I think I'd agree. I'd like to know more on the detail as well on it. Hopefully that will become a bit clearer next week. But thank you. Thank you for that. I have no other questions at this point.
I'm just wondering, Pam, if you've got questions for the next theme and spending priorities, if you want to start us off there, and then we'll bring Jeremy in after that.
Thank you, Convener. So moving on to the spending priorities, and in particular, we've already mentioned employability. I think, Frank, you raised that as well. Are you aware, Frank, of any impact that the employability services or the employability cuts will have on the employability services that you deliver?
I think immediately, I think we are feeling that some of the contracts that we have in place, we don't have immediate fears about. I think it is renewal of those contracts further into the future is where we would have a potential concern, and certainly it's something that we are actively engaged, needless to say, with Scottish Government around what the nature of those cuts, where those cuts are going to fall, is going to be. Some of the assurances, the early assurances that we've had is that employability for disabled people will be less impacted than some of the other programmes that were planned. And obviously that is something that we would certainly want to see. It is a concern that we have that Scotland does seem to be lagging a little bit on addressing the disability employment gap. The disability employment gap in Scotland sits at roughly 32.8%, which is higher than the UK-wide average of 28.4%. We also note that the disability pay gap in Scotland at 18.5% is the highest of the four UK nations. So we certainly feel it is a priority area for action, and would certainly have concerns if, as we've seen the £53 million cut to employability, we have concerns that that is misdirected, that that's perhaps an error. Again, we have no doubt that will impact us as an organisation going forward. Certainly into future years, but I think we would certainly feel it as the wrong priority. Again, I noted the Deputy First Minister's comments at the time of the statement that it was related to a more buoyant jobs market. But I think the thing is that it's the barriers to employment for disabled people are not the number of vacancies that are in the economy. Those barriers are far more complex. And specialist employability support is extremely important to support a lot of disabled people into the jobs market. And we just felt that was perhaps a misconnection between the two issues that we would certainly like to see rectified.
Thank you. That's actually helpful, really clear. Thank you. And my question in a similar area around some of the spending priorities for you, Gordon, was the you highlighted in your submission to us that there's been a 17% rise in children's homelessness, which is tragic. And you've also noted that the flat cash settlement is setting councils up to fail. Do you have concerns about any of the priorities in the recent DFM cuts or the flat cash settlements in terms of the delivery of the child poverty delivery plan, particularly in relation to housing?
Yes, and I think it's mainly around the local government settlement would be the concern. In our action plan, we call for an audit of the money that's actually spent on housing and homelessness services. That's because it is quite atomised. You know, so some local authorities are in partnership with with health bodies, and so how that's delivered, it's not always obvious. And therefore, being able to track how that goes up and down over the years can be very challenging, especially for a third sector body like us. But what we can see is that a flat cash settlement is in effect a cut just at a time when demand is growing. And the Scottish Government, to their credit, have repeatedly brought in and injected pots of cash at various steps. It's not, we recognise it's not recent history, it's not been a one moment only event. But that doesn't allow for the type of planning and the type of quality services that we think could have the long-term impact. So what we've called for is some different choices. We think on the capital side, they can choose to make sure all the money already allocated, so not even if we don't increase the capital programme, but let's make sure all of that goes into social housing rather than mid-market rent and low-cost home ownership. We think that's a proportionate response to the nature of the crisis right now. And on the revenue side, we think there's because the pressures do not fall equally across all 32 local authorities, there's a role for an emergency fund of the sort that the Scottish Government have brought in the past to really target that money at where homelessness is most acute and where the pressure to access accommodation is most acute. And that's largely in the east. The challenges in the west tend to be more around access to properties and the work done with local authority and RSLs, whereas in the east it's literally just the number of homes that are available. But the service delivery side of that is where we see, as we saw recently, people been asked to go to Newcastle to access 7 days emergency accommodation, and that was deemed a reasonable offer. Now, those families had, children about to go, it was the day before somebody was due to go back to school in Edinburgh, and another person had a job in Edinburgh. That's not reasonable, and we know why the local authorities are needing to make an offer and do what they can. They can't do more without access to more resource and more capability. So we think there are different choices without necessarily unpicking the whole of the spending priorities of the Scottish Government.
Thank you. I have no other questions on that either. Thank you.
Many thanks for that. I'll turn now to questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. I wonder, Gordon, can I go back to previous questions asked by Pam around the legislation that's going to be introduced next week. Now, I appreciate we don't know the legislation. We're going to see it, I think, an hour before committee sits. But I've had a number of constituents, and obviously this is an Edinburgh low rent, maybe more issue, but a number of people who have got rent to buy properties. So, their mortgage has been paid by the rent, with the mortgage possibly now going up because of inflation and interest rates. Are you concerned that these people will have to withdraw their flats, properties from the market, and one of the other unforeseen circumstances could be actually less housing available for rent because people can't actually meet the mortgage payments?
One of the things we would say is that it shouldn't be a given that an extreme example of a lender repossession of the property that a sitting tenant should be evicted. I mean, there are ways of looking at the grounds for possession that would ensure that the tenant who's paid their rent throughout the time they've met their contractual obligations, it should, given the relatively high number, I don't have the figures to hand, but the relatively high number of open market purchases that are by buy-to-let landlords, it's clearly attractive to have a sitting tenant in situ. So something we would certainly look to in the emergency legislation is whether there should be a suspension of the grounds for lender possession during that period, just to protect tenants. It's emergency legislation. These are extraordinary times. But on the broader point of the trend of private landlords leaving the market, it certainly is happening. It's difficult to identify what the difference between the number of landlords leaving and the number of properties leaving the sector. The two are not necessarily the same. But that's why I come back to our proposal about the Scottish Government actually has a role in buying properties. And again, if there are landlords, property owners in financial crisis, it's reasonable to seek to support them. One of the ways they could do that is at market rate or a suitable rate, seek to purchase that and keep the tenant in the property, because otherwise we find more people being made homeless, more people coming into the state system at a time when we just do not have the properties to meet their needs. So a pragmatic, proportionate response, we think, is to think creatively around how landlords in financial peril have an exit route, if that's the right thing for them, but that the tenant retains their tenancy.
Thank you. And we'll be interested to see what comes next week. Last week, in the evidence we took, many of the groups said there just wasn't open transparency in regard to how the budget is set last year. There wasn't particular engagement. They didn't get the information required. I wonder, do you agree that additional information would be helpful when engaging in the budget process as we look forward to next year? And I'm happy to start with Frank and then go to Gordon, so if that's okay.
Yeah, I think it would certainly be helpful to us as an organisation and as a charity if we did have an earlier sight of the considerations that were going into the budget process. I think our submissions in that process will generally be around our priority areas, around good funding for health and social care, funding for the frontline workforce, support for employability, support for people remaining active and engaged in their community, and the opportunities that there are for people with learning disabilities and other disabled people to participate. But I think certainly we would feel more able to make the most constructive possible submissions if we had the best possible information on which to base that. Again, I reflect on the Deputy First Minister's challenge. I think we would be better equipped to perhaps offer some alternatives and some suggestions if we were party to some more of the information. I think there is always the risk that in engaging the third sector with sort of limited scope and a fairly wide and broad agenda there, we will always default to our main priority issues, and I think we can probably engage more constructively if there is more information available to us around the parameters that the government is working within, then we would probably be able to offer some more innovative solutions, because needless to say, we all want to get the best we possibly can for not only for the people that we represent as an organisation, but for Scotland more widely. And we certainly want to be able to engage in finding solutions and not always just be lobbying sort of blind in a space that we don't really have the full information around the parameters that we're working within. So I think that would certainly be helpful to us as an organisation.
From a Shelter Scotland perspective, I can make no complaint about the level of access and engagement we have with Scottish Government. I think they're probably bored to tears hearing from us. I think the issue more is around how third sector bodies engage beyond their silo, beyond our sector issues. So I've got no qualms that housing and homelessness policymakers reach out to us to understand what that would look like on the ground when time allows, when there's a process. I think the bigger challenge, and I think it follows on from what Frank's saying, but also from panellists earlier on, is to have a genuinely human rights-based approach to budgeting, to look at the panel approach, so that we can see what is the role of the health budget when it comes to meeting for people with multiple complex needs in the homelessness system who require access to mental health services. You know, that is a bill that gets picked up in the housing sector. If we're going to really look at an open and transparent approach to budgeting, that's the kind of conversations that are required to be had. And I'm sure there's parallels with other policy areas. So I think we have, again, very good intentions from Scottish ministers, but not yet the delivery for putting that approach to inclusive budgeting in place.
Thank you very much for that. We'll turn to questions from Emma Roddick to be followed by Miles Briggs. Emma.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Gordon. I have a few questions about two very big policy matters and how they affect homelessness. So if we could do a little bit of quick fire, then I would appreciate that. The Parliament expects next week to deliberate on the emergency legislation around a rent freeze, and I'm sure you'll be painfully familiar with the arguments that this could increase homelessness because landlords take their properties out of the rental market. Is that a legitimate concern?
It's up to Parliament to put protections in place to make sure that's not the consequence. And as I mentioned in reply to Jeremy Balfour, I think there are areas around the grounds for possession and also recognising that Scotland now has quite a suite of tools from licensing around short-term lets, empty homes levy. There are actually a number of policy levers that can be pulled to get a maximal benefit of every property, and I think it's having that joined-up approach that would make the difference.
From a fundamental standpoint, should ensuring that people can afford to keep a roof over their head be a greater priority than allowing landlords to increase their rents?
We would certainly say that the role of government is to ensure citizens have the access to their human right to a home, and if for any reason that's in conflict with the interests of business groups, then I think if there is a choice to be made, it wouldn't come as a surprise that we would say back the choice that protects people.
Thank you. And do you think that the rent freeze will have a positive impact on tenants, and could it help prevent homelessness?
I think it'll have a positive impact on tenants as a whole. I think it will have a relatively marginal impact on people at the lower end of the market.
Do you think it could prevent people who would have otherwise become homeless due to not being able to afford a rent increase from becoming so?
Yes, and obviously with the events of the last few days, that issue has become more acute. When this was first proposed, I think people were expecting a couple of percentage points, potentially up to 6% next year. That's now been blown out of the water. So the rent freeze proposal, and again, we don't know the detail of it, we don't know how it's going to be enforced, we don't know what policy lever mechanism is going to be used, and we're talking here in the private rented sector, is very welcome in the context of the cost of living. I think what I would reinforce is that universal versus targeted responses are always a difficult choice, and we recognise the desire to make a universal approach here, but let's not lose sight of the additional need to have quite targeted support for people at the lower end.
And finally, thinking about the eviction ban during the pandemic, from your perspective, did that have a positive impact on tackling homelessness?
Unquestionably. I mean, we did not see the spike in homelessness that would have occurred otherwise. And the Scottish Government, through their PRS Resilience Group and the Social Housing Resilience Group, brought stakeholders together, made it work. We understand there will be a very similar approach to how the evictions moratorium will be brought in, and that's to be welcomed. However, there does need to be planning for making sure that the court system is robust enough, that advice organisations and legal representation is available for people once the moratorium is lifted, because otherwise we'll end up with another bottleneck. And we're already beginning to see the system catching up on itself on some of those delayed evictions from the pandemic.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, Emma. And I remember vividly those days of all the meetings that we were having in terms of bringing all the sectors together to try and implement that at the time. Miles?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. Earlier we heard the Deputy First Minister instilling the virtues of Ireland in their policy agendas. And I just wondered, in terms of the impact of the rent control policy we've seen in Ireland, for example, a 30% increase in homelessness, 38% increase in Dublin alone. Whether or not you think the government haven't looked at the unintended consequences of this rent freeze policy?
Well, I think the Irish example is more around rent controls, is my understanding, than rent freezes as proposed in the emergency legislation. Historically, at Shelter Scotland, we've taken the view that what's called first-generation rent controls can have the unintended consequence of setting a floor rather than a ceiling for rents. However, I'm not aware of anyone truly proposing that kind of first-generational rent control in the upcoming housing legislation. So very much like my response to Emma Roddick there. We want to see the detail. We don't take an ideological view on what's good policy and what's bad policy. We want to see what it says. The rent freeze itself, as I said, is welcome insofar as we know how it will be delivered. And in the Ireland example, I would need to know more about the direct cause and effect between the rent controls and the lack of general supply, because there was also a massive crash in supply in Ireland due to the financial crisis that is still working its way through. So disaggregating that from the rent control policy, I think it would require an academic. I'm sure that you had Ken Gibb here a couple of weeks ago. I'm sure Ken could tell you more.
Yeah, that's helpful. We're also waiting to see the bill and probably won't until an hour before the committee has to look at this. But I wondered specifically with regards to rural homelessness, and it's something we maybe don't talk enough about, supply and demand in these cases is often hugely limited. So has there been any work done which you know of about potential consequences for rural homelessness?
Not to my knowledge as a kind of specific piece of work, but there is certainly a focus that's come from the Cabinet Secretary around certainly using 10% of the supply programme to increase accessibility and availability in rural Scotland. And through the housing options hubs that local government convene, a lot of best practice sharing amongst those more rural local authorities around how do you make temporary accommodation provisions in small towns when you're trying to keep people connected to the school and their employment and all those things. And it's incredibly challenging. The Perth and Kinross, who are not entirely rural local authority, but certainly have large rural areas, have some really kind of advanced approaches to providing temporary accommodation by bringing in private rented sector and doing a lot of tenancy support work at a very early stage. And we think they're certainly, they get slightly, both have been referenced as the high watermark, but there's certainly lessons that other rural local authorities can learn from there. And it is ultimately about partnership. It is about the availability of homes, but it is also about the quality of the services and sustaining the investment in those services.
And just finally, I wanted to ask, it's something I've raised consistently. We are seeing a really depressing picture, worrying picture, with regards to the number of children in temporary accommodation here in the capital. That is at a crisis point, I would say. Where do you think the Scottish Government is going wrong in terms of that policy direction?
I think not to get too existential, but I think there's a bigger Scottish politics issue that we focus on the thing that's happening right in front of us. And there had been an incredible amount of focus on housing options, on ending homes together, on the overlooked, long, far too long overlooked needs of people with multiple and complex needs. At the exact same time, we saw this growth in children temporary accommodation because we weren't building enough homes of the right size. By its very nature, families require larger properties. We had a supply programme that was not solely, but predominantly focused on smaller units. What we've now found ourselves is we don't have the larger units, and that's the main issue. So that's why, unapologetically, we keep coming back to it's about supply. All roads and housing lead back to supply of social housing. If we can drive up by buying and by building more larger properties, then we'll be able to deal with that. And the Temporary Accommodation Task Force, Task and Finish Group, that the Scottish Government have convened as part of the Homelessness Prevention Strategy Group, co-chaired by Shelter Scotland's Director Alison Watson, has already made interim recommendations calling for a national acquisition plan for that very reason.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Jeremy, you've got a follow-up question?
Just a quick question, Gordon. It was interesting. I was meeting with one of the fairly large homelessness charities in Edinburgh on Monday, and they were talking about with the people coming from Ukraine, how that then impacts on the demand that is already there. Now, obviously, we all welcome having the Ukrainians coming in to Edinburgh and to other parts of Scotland, but how do we then deal with those who are still on the list? And practically, would you see the way forward in regard to keeping people within the central belt, whether it's perhaps, or do you see more of a policy? We discussed this previously in another report for the Women's Committee. Is it better to say, let's distribute people around the whole of Scotland? And I just wondered if you had a view around that, because obviously it's going to go on for a number of months, if not years now, and what's the longer term issue around this?
So I think it's incredibly important to say that we mustn't allow a situation where there's even a perception of our ability to welcome people fleeing conflict to be played off against the needs of homeless people here in Scotland. And I'm very struck by the Scottish Refugee Council's own submission to this committee references our call for new supply for that very reason. We note the announcement last week of £50 million bid fund for local authorities to try and bring existing void social properties back into use. Very welcome what capacity there is to do that, but it also shows that where there is a will to make better use of existing properties, we can do it. What we need is an integrated approach that says the more people we can get out of temporary accommodation and into permanent accommodation, well, there we create capacity within the temporary accommodation sector so that we can meet the needs of Ukrainian refugees and other communities fleeing conflict. We think that's that kind of chain, if you like, of address the needs of people in the homelessness temporary accommodation system to free up capacity for people coming from Ukraine who maybe aren't being well, whose hosting situation falls through, or who are currently being accommodated in unsatisfactory accommodation, such as the floating refugee centres and the ships. That integrated approach is key. What we also hear from local authority partners is there is a risk of some opportunity cost. There's only so many people. There's only so many heads of housing. There's only so many senior managers able to deliver these services, and they're spending an awful lot of time on Ukraine. And we worry that there's not the capacity to also do the homelessness work at the same time. So very much share the concerns, but think we can and we should be able to do both.
Can I just push you a wee bit, Gordon, Mike? Because I think what you suggest is all very sensible. But it's at best medium term. And I suppose the question I have around this is, I don't think a floating boat is a solution beyond a very short period of time. So what's the short term is the short term answer to this?
I'm sorry, I didn't come back to you on the dispersal element of your question. But I think the longer term answer is that the housing needs of a community like the Ukrainian refugees, but similar, needs to be one that's dispersed across the country, that we make the best use of the accommodation that we have. But that has to be reasonable for that household. We need houses, but sustaining a house is about connection to the community, it's about access to jobs, it's about access to family and support networks. So there's no point pushing someone in a property up in Elgin if all the support network is in Edinburgh. So we have to be sensible, but we also have to be pragmatic. And as I say, I think this is not the paradox that I think some in government have sought to make it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm wondering, Frank, from your perspective and the people that Enable supports, do you have any thing that you want to mention at this point when we're discussing homelessness?
I think it's not been a huge issue that's come through among our membership, if I'm perfectly honest. I think for a lot of our members, will either be living with family members who may be homeowners themselves. Some of our members will own their own homes, and a lot of our members who are renting, it's generally social rent that they will have. So I think we'll bow to Gordon's knowledge on homelessness and housing and his expertise there. But from Enable's perspective, it's not been an issue that's come through strongly from our membership to date.
Many thanks for that, Frank. I'll bring Paul McLennan in a wee minute, but I just want to, Gordon, take you back to discuss you know, the proposals that Shelter has around about changing the approach to affordable housing, specifically round about whether looking at it in a national perspective. You know, you'll be well aware previously as the COSLA spokesperson, that's a very tense moment if you think about 32 local authorities looking at where that grant money is going and where their share and that's going to be. What do you think the benefit of that national approach could be? And if we think as well about, you know, the Empty Homes Partnership, where could we improve upon you know, the speed and the pace at which we can work collectively to buy back those properties and force that kind of movement from properties that are sitting empty? And as well, round about, you know, the type of properties that councils and registered social landlords are building in terms of them being able to be convertible. So maybe built for a 2 or 3 bedroom, but could maybe be going to a 4 if they're built with capacity within the loft, etc. So a few thoughts in there, but just if you can expand on it a wee bit.
Many thoughts. I think the immediate priority, I would say, is we all share the desire to have a long-term affordable housing programme that sustains, that builds good quality accommodation, that those individual houses meet people's adaptive needs over the lifetime. But we can't get away from the fact we have a bubble in temporary accommodation right now. And we think the benefit of a nationally led, it'd have to be delivered in partnership with local authorities, local ISLs, but by taking it out of the normal local government funding mechanism, and saying this is going to be targeted where we think it can have the greatest impact to reduce affordable housing need, allows us to put an interim programme in place that can turn the dial on the levels of children and families in temporary accommodation. And that's what we're seeking to do here. So we're not necessarily suggesting that the Scottish Government becomes a landlord. We're suggesting the Scottish Government direct a purchasing programme that looks at, you know, what are the former right to buy properties that are coming back onto the market, you know, within the current constraints of individual local authorities, many of whom, including in this city, are already buying properties, but are they able to do it at scale and at speed to meet the levels of demand? We don't think they are. We think from our conversations with local authorities that they would welcome that, certainly those local authorities under greatest pressure. And I think it's probably a question of capacity and skills within Scottish Government to be able to direct that. But if the principle is agreed, let's target additional resource where it will reduce affordable housing need. Then that requires direction. It can't just be a bid-in system based on who's got a land site that's ready to go, who's shovel ready. You know, it's not so much passive, but it's reactive. We need to be proactive in identifying where we can put a resource for the greatest benefit.
Thank you. I think, Miles, have you got a supplementary question?
Thank you, Convener. Just briefly on that point, and to go back to the rent controls policy and the unintended consequence. Now, the Scottish Government have set themselves a target of 110,000 affordable homes. Now, part of what we are now hearing from housing associations is them not being able to deliver that. So I just wondered, in terms of what you said, in terms of that, the need for more supply, actually, what impact do you think that's going to have? Or have you spoken to housing associations around this policy as well? Because they are adamant that they are really concerned of the very negative consequences this will have on their ability to take forward or have to scrap these projects.
On the rent freeze? We, as I said earlier, we share the concern that if the rent freeze is unfunded, then it will have a negative impact. But again, there are choices the Scottish Government can make. They could, you know, roughly just now, it's a 50-50 split between grant funding and leverage, you know, the landlord borrowing money. So if we want to sustain rent freezes, then that balance could shift more towards grant. I'm not a housing finance expert. I would pretend I'm not a housing economist, so there's people better versed than I. But what we recognise is that the aspiration to ensure that tenants don't have to pay any more money in rent during a period of extreme cost of living crisis is one that we share. The consequences of it, though, have to be understood. They have to be financed, and that's why we're saying buy and build, because those local authorities and RSLs are actually pretty good at purchasing property when it suits their portfolio. All we are saying is we can accelerate that, target it, that takes it beyond the limitations that those individual RSLs and local authorities have, to ensure that the national aspiration of reducing affordable housing needs can be met through national leadership.
Thanks.
Yeah, many thanks for that. And just before I turn to Paul for the last question, I think there are a lot of authorities and RSLs that do have, within councils, delegated authority to heads of housing to do that buyback as soon as they see that, X local authority properties are on the market. So I think it's about perhaps how we, make that quicker and bring pace to that.
Or go beyond just buying former RSL stock.
Yeah, especially when it comes to bigger properties. Mm-hmm. Done that in the past as well when you're looking for a four-bedroom property. Paul, to finish this off.
Thank you, Convener. Gordon, again, just a question for yourself. Maybe just touching on what you said, obviously, about changing the approach to affordable housing and obviously building more social housing. What level of discussions have you had with COSLA on that one? Because obviously they're the other key partners as well as individual local authorities about their view on that in terms of that, because obviously there may be capacity issues around about how they develop that scheme. The second question was really just more specific, was asking about Programme for Government announced an increase to discounted housing payments and extending the eligibility for the tenant grant fund. I'm just wondering what impact you think that will have on tenants, and are there any other further measures that could be taken to address the cost of living for tenants?
So in terms of conversations with COSLA and local government, we haven't had detailed conversations about our action plan in of itself, but as I mentioned, there's already an interim recommendation from the Temporary Accommodation Task and Finish Group that proposes a national acquisition plan to mitigate the lack of temporary accommodation. That is co-chaired by ALACHO, so the Association of Local Chief Housing Officers, and includes a representative from COSLA on it. So as the collective view of that task and finish group, that includes local government chief housing officers. I can't speak for them, but that implicit endorsement. We very much welcome the additional funds and discretionary housing payments and tenant grant fund, the change in the eligibility. Two, I think our reflection on the tenants grant fund would be that it probably hasn't gone far enough into the private rented sector so far. I think the reliance on local authorities as the promoters of it, I think, has bumped up against the challenge that private tenants don't really have a relationship with the local authority. There was a good example during the pandemic where local authorities made use of the landlord registration scheme to write out to all tenants to make them aware of their rights during the eviction moratorium and other things. And we would suggest that's probably something to look at now for making sure that private tenants know that they could access this tenant grant fund, because it's an incredibly hard group of people to reach as a sort of audience segment, if you get into marketing terms.
Yeah, Miles and I both actually sit in the local government housing committee as well, so that's obviously something we can take back to that one as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and thank you both for coming along this morning. And if there's anything you think that you need to follow up in writing with us, please feel free to do so. And I'm now going to close the public part of this meeting and we'll move into private session. Thank you very much.